Now entering Nerdist.com.
Timpani drums.
Yeah, a lot of timpani drums.
A bell.
Yeah.
Darling, I'm killed. I'm in a puddle on the floor.
What?
Or you are the puddle.
No, her vagina is so wet.
Oh, Jesus. Matt, it's early in the morning. Come on.
That's how it goes with James Bond. Oh, yeah. How you tease, how you leave me. Let's set the scene. It's in 1997, right? Mm-hmm. That was the year of the women in music. Lilith Fair was a big deal.
Oh, yeah.
Ah, there it is. I love this song.
I know you do.
Sheryl Crow. They said, hey, why don't you do our song? Because every day is a winding road.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Bond theme songs, you know, sex appeal is so important. And, I mean, you know, when you think female singers that give me a boner, Sheryl Crow obviously jumps to the top of the list. Raw sexuality, I think, is what she gives off.
Who at that time would have been?
Very much to the bottom of the list, if we're actually making
a list.
I'm not a huge fan of this song, but maybe I like Sheryl Crow all right, I guess, but it is an odd choice, right? I mean...
It is. I mean, I think, right, it's like...
Guys, I just set the scene for you telling you how it's not an odd choice. Again, 1997,
well,
Lilith
Fair. You're saying your other options were Sarah McLachlan, Lisa Loeb,
Fiona Apple.
This was Gwen Stefani. Early for Fiona Apple.
No, this was the year of Title. This is
really?
The year of her bonkers speech at the VMAs.
She would have been good.
She would have been great.
Tori Amos, I think, could have sang it, turned us on, and then made us feel bad for being turned on. I think would be the Tori Amos version.
When
of
is
this.
Sixpence None the Richer going to get a Bond song?
Ladies
and gentlemen, this is Jordan Morris joining us today for, what do we call this?
Tomorrow Never Dies.
Listen, I didn't just roll out of bed again.
Tomorrow Never Dies.
That's right.
I love this. I love this movie. I'm the only one.
Listen, can I open with something?
Yes, go.
Okay, look. I noticed a couple of people have written in or tweeted or whatever saying, why would I tune in to listen to a Bond podcast about two guys that don't like the movies? And I think that's a valid criticism, but I want to defend it. We love these movies.
Yes, we do.
Even when we don't like them, my point is, the worst day Brosnaning is better than the best day Schwarzeneggering, if that makes sense. This is all a relative... criticism, right?
Yeah.
Like, I'm not a fan of the Brosnans, but I still love these movies. However, this is the worst one.
So you're saying worst.
Yeah.
Worst Bond movie, or worst Brosnan movie of all. Wow.
Whoa. Yeah. What are you talking about?
I'm glad I could be here on a day where passions are in flame.
Yeah, I will defend this throughout the podcast.
How can you say that? We have been through Die Another Day, mm-hmm. and The World Is Not Enough together.
And I've said this before, because Die Another Day has so much to not like, it's fun. I love when they go big or go home. So yes, when they make huge missteps, it's more fun than this weird... To me, this is kind of down the road mediocrity, middle of the road, just garden variety.
I think that's a fair criticism, and I think you can see that a lot. You know, that same phenomenon at work a lot in the Fast and Furious movies.
Yeah, yeah.
The most fun of those are the ones where they go for broke.
Yeah, yeah. yeah.
And it's super bonkers.
Yeah.
And your Tokyo drifts, which, you know.
I haven't seen it, but I'm prepared to take your word on that.
I think Tokyo Drift is the Tomorrow Never Dies of the Fast and Furious franchise.
Yeah.
I'm very interested in why you dislike this movie so much. I feel like of the Bond movies from the era of 85 to current, well, to let's say to 2004.
Pre-Craig.
Yeah. I feel like this is the most James Bondian, the most formulaic James Bond movie.
My problem comes with the tone, and we've talked about this before. So Roger Moore's films had some tonal issues, but they were mostly all kind of lighthearted camp, and then he'd occasionally slap a woman, and you'd go, ooh, gross. This one seems to fluctuate like almost half and half. So with Paris Carver's death, it's really asking you to take it seriously. And then you cut to Elliot Carver, and he's just what is going on with this guy? And people seem to like him as a villain, and I don't know what it is.
I like him a lot.
You know what? Here's the thing about the villain is, I mean, and obviously this is just having a modern perspective, but I pity him because his plan is based around, what are the three tenets of his plan? Newspapers, yep. magazines, yep. and television.
It's yes. so unengaging.
James Bond didn't have to take this guy down. He just yes. needed to wait 5 years for the internet to do it. Like, this guy, he could have maybe have ruled the world from 1997 to 2002.
Yeah.
Then mm-hmm. just the Huffington yeah. Post would have destroyed him.
I just feel like the writers went, let's not think of a story. Let's think of something that's current, you know, and just, I don't know, the whole news thing and the ridiculousness that he could get away with murdering people and causing a war just so he could sell papers. It's just too preposterous.
Well, here's also the thing that I like about the villain yeah. is he is not secret about his evil.
I know.
For the first time we see him at that party, he's basically confessing to what he's doing, but on a smaller scale. He's at a party and he's like, well, surely I didn't invent mad cow disease just to shame a beef magnate who lost to me in poker. And everyone's laughing. He's basically, you know, he's confessing to a smaller crime. Yeah. That's the exact crime.
Yeah.
Though.
Yeah, and it's delivered as if a punchline has just been said in yeah. a party. You come in and, oh.
Yeah, you would think that his public face would be one of, like, you know, moral impeccability.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
But no, he's fine being seen as evil in public.
Yes.
I remember the Siskel and Ebert review of this movie, and I remember Gene Siskel taking my side and saying that they really enjoyed the villain in this movie. Mm. Well, think of it. He's like a Ted Turner, Steve Jobsian kind of...
Rupert Murdoch more than anybody,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
Yeah, probably. That's exactly where that came from.
Although yeah. I think the actor was certainly having a lot of fun.
Jonathan
sure
Pryce
was.
Only
sure.
has fun in movies.
Sure was.
I think they're the two unsung villains of this are the German torture fellas.
Oh, that he beats up in the room? Oh, wait, are you talking about Vincent Chiavo?
I'm talking about the henchman and Dr. Yeah. Kaufman.
Yeah, I thought Dr. Kaufman scene was terrific.
I loved it, too. Didn't belong in this movie.
No, yeah.
The tone of that scene yeah. didn't fit anything.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And that the blonde, sexy Ted Haggard-looking guy, Stamper, you know that Reverend Ted Haggard?
Stamper!
He looks like him. He's got a weird sort of eye problem.
Yes.
And I like how they dress him like an, you know, East Coast crew team
yes.
wasp. He has all these like tight sweaters. He's great. I loved those. Yeah.
By the way, very funny. I watched some special features on the movie, and when that guy is talking, so much more feminine.
Really?
In life, yeah.
Oh boy.
They're so clearly trying to make him a Red Grant.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
just,
yeah.
From Russia with Love, but we're ahead of ourselves.
Let's start with asking you,
yeah,
Jordan.
Yeah.
About your life growing up with James Bond. Did
well,
you were you a fan or what?
So here was my relationship to Bond when I was. Of the age that one is when one gets into Bond. When I was
2 months?
When I was 2 months old, uh-huh. yeah. you know, when you're supposed to get into James Bond.
Suckling at the teat of Fleming.
Exactly. Fleming. Right. You know, when I was, you know, 11 through 15, mm-hmm. my favorite movies were your blood sports, your kickboxers.
Oh, sure. Yeah, sure.
Your commandos.
Yeah.
So when my dad would rent a James Bond movie and say, like, now... Oh, you like action movies? You'll love this. I was bored to tears.
Yeah.
I specifically yeah. remember watching Goldfinger with him
uh-huh.
and just thinking to myself, they're playing golf. Like, half of this movie is golf. And just really not understanding. It really seemed to me like the product of another age. And specifically, more specifically of like, British stuff people try and push on you. So I put this in the same camp as like Babar and Paddington and like other
yeah,
boring British
little,
stuff people
yes,
think kids should
I
like.
I see what you're saying. Yeah, yeah.
So it was kind of not till later, not till college.
So it was touch and go for a while. For
it was yeah. touch and go. Yeah, yeah.
Could have easily not happened.
Yeah.
But thank God it did.
But yeah, but I definitely.
So when you get to college, what was the Bond movie that came out?
Rewatching Goldfinger.
Oh, okay.
And going like, oh no, this is a great, really fun movie.
Yeah.
I mean, despite the golf, there's a lot
yeah.
of, you know,
there is
there's too
golf.
Much golf. And yeah, I mean, I went to see GoldenEye in theaters.
Mm-hmm. Christmas 1995.
I was 13 and went to see every movie in every theater.
Yeah.
And certainly played a lot of GoldenEye on N64.
Oh, of course.
If I'm being honest, that's maybe the Bond property that I feel the most connection to.
A lot of people do. Yeah.
That game is so good.
Did you
ever play it?
I never played it when it... I played it once or twice when it was out, but I just didn't have a console at the time.
I loved that you could you could play as Oddjob, Jaws.
Yeah.
Who else did that? I feel like... Oddjob and Jaws were the two. Alec Trevelyan, obviously, you could play as.
Russian soldier.
Yeah, you could play. You could play as Draco from. Not Draco. What the fuck is the guy's Moonraker's villain's name?
Drax.
Drax.
Oh.
You could play as Drax, too.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I know people want us to do an episode based on the video games, so maybe we should dig all those out and have a roll through.
Let's do it.
Yeah. Most of them are very bad, though, right?
Yeah. Yes.
The newer ones are
particularly bad, Although Bloodstone's pretty good.
Yeah, I played that.
Yeah.
I might argue that GoldenEye is not a terrific game, but the thing about GoldenEye that people liked was it was the first time on a console you could do multiplayer death matches.
Yeah.
So I remember they had GoldenEye HD come out.
Own, yeah.
And I was super nostalgic and was really excited when that came out and popped it in, and I'm like, FPSs have gotten a lot better. This has a lot of problems.
But it's kind of interesting. I mean, I recommend, like, if you're listening and I guarantee you can get it for like $10 somewhere.
Yeah, I think you can even download it.
But get it. It's kind of fun. Okay. It's kind of fun watching being in the world of GoldenEye, but with like the graphics of today. Well, the graphics of
the
five
graphics
years,
of
7 years
5
ago.
Years ago. Yeah, sure.
I had a Commodore 64.
As did I, my friend.
I'm glad to hear. And they
that sounds like a Bond villain. Commodore 64.
They had
Commodore 64.
A Spy Who Loved Me game for the Commodore 64 that I had, and do you remember Yar's Revenge for Atari?
Yeah,
you had no concept of what was happening on the screen. The graphics were not good
enough.
Yar's
Revenge and Robotron 2024, also another game that's incomprehensible.
Yes, because the graphics aren't good enough to represent anything recognizable. Right. So
you're in a land of a million boxes.
Yeah.
A lot of text input, right?
Well, it wasn't. It was actually the Lotus underwater trying to get to it, the Atlantis dome of Stromberg. So you could make it out, but it just was. It wasn't great. But
I was a big fan of the.
Just play that music over and over.
I enjoyed the Ghostbusters Commodore 64 game. I played that quite a bit.
Yeah.
Those big floppy discs.
Mine was a cartridge. I didn't even have a disc drive.
Oh, no?
We didn't have a disc drive, and my stepdad had a cassette memory device. Do you remember that? And it would work.
We had that, too.
Maybe 60% of the time it worked, and it took, like, 40 minutes to memorize a program, and so he wouldn't let me use it. Anyway.
The monitor from the Commodore 64?
We had a monitor. I had to use our TV.
Well, we had a monitor, and it lived long enough for that to become my television in my bedroom through high school.
Yeah, you could do worse.
It was pretty good.
Like
was
me,
good.
I didn't even have a monitor.
So, Tomorrow Never Dies. Had you seen it?
I remember going to see it in the theaters in
1997. Because your choices that winter were Titanic. On 40 screens.
That's why I didn't see
Tomorrow Never Dies or Spice World. I vividly remember this movie theater time of my life.
See, you saying those three movies have now just solely or just soundly put me back into a relationship I was in at the time. Because I think I went to see Titanic.
Yeah.
But this is the only Bond movie I haven't seen in the theater since Octopussy.
Oh, my God. How did you miss this?
I think I saw GoldenEye, and I know this is blasphemous to some people. It just was like, and I'm not buying this Brosnan, and it didn't go back.
You are fucked up in the head right now, because I'm going to correct you on why this is the greatest James Bond movie
ever made
of the 90s.
Oh boy, we're going to have words now.
Of the 90s,
Jordan,
and early 2000s.
Surprisingly, our Bond favorites and disfavorites. I just woke up. They line up pretty well. Yep. This is really
this
the
is
only
biggest,
one where
this
we're
is our
no,
biggest
and
disagreement.
And it's funny. I've been listening to the show. I've been enjoying it very much.
Thank you very much.
It's a favorite of
your household?
Pop culture happy hours. Glenn Weldon.
Oh yeah,
podcast tastes
guy.
I trust.
Yes.
And so I. I've heard this movie come up in other podcasts where this movie is not the topic, and I got really excited. I'm like, oh, good, I get to be there on the day where they disagree.
It's here. It's here. So let's jump into this thing, right?
Okay.
Let's roll. Let's Tomorrow Never Dies it. All right.
Tomorrow Notes or Dies.
Tomorrow Never Notes is what I got.
Okay.
Did you name your notes?
No. I
okay.
Didn't.
Look at that. This little notepad
guys,
you have,
this
though.
I'm sorry. I'm
this
sorry.
Notepad looks.
Do you want
I feel
me to
like
leave?
What do you got? You got a soft moleskin there?
It got a field note.
Oh, I
nice.
Got one of those.
Nice. Field, field notes are
nice.
Good.
Malleable. Fits in the back pocket really well.
I like that a lot.
You can bend it.
All right. Let's talk.
I'm
about
sorry, I didn't name the notes. So, do you guys just want to get Howard Kramer in here or something?
Yeah. Let's
I
have.
Can leave.
You live by the Grove, you die by the Grove. Oh, Howard, I love Howard. Okay. So here we go.
I thought you were saying that because you know I live by the Grove.
I do too. Are we very close neighbors?
I think we are.
Oh my God. We'll talk about it.
Fairfax and Blackburn. Wow.
Oh, you're on that side. I'm on the La Brea side.
Fairfax and Blackburn.
Okay, guys. It's very important. We open up with the gun barrel sequence. Mm-hmm. Which I believe is reshot for this movie.
Okay.
The only thing I wrote when that happened was a little on the nose.
The film quality, I think, is odd looking. There's a yellow tinge to him
really?
That I don't enjoy. But then we open up on cold open.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for an arms bazaar.
An arms bazaar.
Come on, come
in
on.
In quotes.
Yeah.
As though there were flyers passed out.
Yes, yeah, see, already.
All the terrorists
camped. The very first thing
Sunday
you could watch.
Sunday Farmer's Market.
Yes. Yes.
Saturday Arms Bazaar.
The there are a lot of chatter happening in MI6. Mm-hmm. So
don't you mean a lot of really heavy handed exposition?
Yes.
That's the other thing is the script is the exposition is so horrible. It's so
but people didn't know what the fuck GPS was then.
But still
every time the acronym GPS comes up here, people say it with such relish. People
GPS,
are like,
Global Positioning Satellite.
Your car is equipped with, you know, rockets, the latest defense technologies, and
GPS tracking system. All in all, I always go into John Cleese as R, The Arms Bazaar. I want to hear a little bit of
it's even better. What is it? A terrorist arms
I think instead
bazaar.
Of an arms bazaar, they should just call it like a MacGuffin garage sale.
Yes.
What
other kind of arms
MacGuffin
bazaar is there?
Sale.
Like, get your MacGuffins here.
Terrorist arms bazaar.
Meaningless tech boxes.
By the way, the location they give us on the Russian border.
Oh.
So,
a terrorist arms bazaar.
Katie, I'm going to play something on here. Are we good to. Second? Okay, here we go. Now what we're seeing is a camera in the snow. Very, very James Bond, the thing you would expect to see.
Sure, sure, whatever.
And who's got this camera? Oh, it's MI6. That
not,
guy,
not the most
Ricky J.
Not the most inconspicuous camera in the
yeah,
world.
Yeah, no, I know, it's but
it's also the loudest servo motor in history. And here we are in
our
MI6.
Position on the center camera.
It's not even like under anything, it's just sticking
like
up in the
supermarket.
Snow.
Chinese Long March Scud. Panther AS-565 attack helicopter, a pair of Russian mortars, and the crates look like American rifles. Chilean mines, German explosives, fun for the whole family.
Jesus.
IDs.
The White Knight. Show us the pawns.
You see, he did get through, Admiral. Start with that chap in the middle.
Load the ID.
Database ID search.
I had forgotten about the Tokyo subway attack until
Satoshi Isaguro.
Oh right.
What is that? Yeah, what is that a reference to? I thought they were just.
It was a real thing.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Okay. That seems in bad taste.
That's what I'm saying about the tone of this movie.
American.
Hey, I'm Admiral Jowles.
I love this guy.
This at Berkeley in the 60s.
Bit of color commentary.
That he used to be a super lefty, and now,
now
he's
he sells his politics
up,
for cash.
Straight up terrorist.
So we're at MI6 base of operations, right?
Uh-huh.
Which is something I enjoy seeing in a James Bond movie.
You know what I liked about this, and kind of something I wanted to see more of, is them taking shots at other countries' secret organizations. Mm. I like them talking about like, do you think the CIA would be angry about this? Do you think they'll be angry? They lost it, or angry that we found it. I like that. I would like to see a cocktail party where all the secret organizations get together and just are shitty to each other.
That'd be fun. That'd be fun. I'd go to that cocktail party. So of course we're seeing our what do we call Ricky Jay's character?
He's not a henchman exactly. Right. He's that.
I think he's just a hacker, just a tech guy.
Yeah,
the 90s.
He's like the
hacker.
He's like the black guy rather in Die Hard.
Okay.
The guy that hacks the computer system for them, and
but his Bond analogous character would be like in Die Another Day, that weird blonde looking doctor, or for Zorin in View to a Kill, the old German doctor. There's always like some German kind of mentor.
Here's the missed opportunity with Ricky Jay in this movie.
He's not doing any close-up magic.
Yeah. He's also not hurling cards at someone's
head. But there is a deleted scene, right, of that.
Is there?
I believe so.
I mean,
I am a big Ricky Jay fan. I like his NPR commentaries a lot. I think those are insightful. I like his little exhibit at the Museum of Jurassic Technology. I am a Ricky Jay fan.
Sure, me too. I think I know where you're going with this.
He looks like he doesn't know how to be in a movie.
He does.
he looks like he's not sure that he's in a movie.
Yeah.
Or when the camera is
rolling. He's acting with the disinterest that the waitress's lead singer lady sang.
Look at Rick. If you're watching this movie after this podcast,
or before, that'd be the wise decision.
Yes, watch Ricky Jay, and then just listen to his voice and realize that there's no way those are the two same people.
You know, it's funny. I heard that.
Does he get overdone?
No, he doesn't. I'm just saying his actual voice does not in any way match with his
he had a little part in the Christian Bale Hugh Jackman magician movie
the Prestige.
And I guess he was famously overdubbed for that because they thought his voice was too weird.
It is weird.
Really?
Yeah, so
I think
when you watch that movie, that is not Ricky Jay's voice, and I think he's famously angry about it.
That did not strike me as a thing watching but I've seen him speak so many times that I just always have associated
there's something oddly contemporary, like he almost sounds like a young woman or something just in his dialogue.
We're never gonna get him on our Close Up Magic podcast.
That's true.
You ruined it.
I'm sorry. Can I say that though?
Maybe you can get him on your Circus Sideshow podcast, though.
I hope so.
Also, something he's an expert in.
By the way, Bond does something here in this movie. Pierce Brosnan's James Bond in his Armani leather jacket. So here's the deal, guys. Let's set the stage for the viewer. Or listener, rather, assuming they haven't viewed the movie. James Bond is there. He's at this terrorist arms bazaar on the Russian border. And he is, he's got to make sure that they
are... First Sunday of every month, by the way.
So what, here's my question.
Yeah.
You know what I like about going to the terrorist bazaar?
What?
Is you get your Scud missiles and they're fresh.
Yeah.
They're fresh. Mm-hmm. There's not pesticides on them.
No, and don't even get me started about some of the vintage RPGs they have there. They need work, but they're beautiful.
Have you seen the handcrafted cozies for the magazines for the M16?
Adorable.
No.
They are great. And all the money goes to terrorism.
The hipsters are a little rough. Like, getting through the crowd of hipsters is tough.
I don't understand.
Small batch flamethrowers.
But it makes, this already makes no sense why James Bond is here. Why is James Bond at this arms bazaar? If their two options are send in the Russian military or fire a missile at it, there's no reason for James Bond to be there.
This script is the worst script ever written for James Bond.
But James Bond's there, so buckle in, okay? Because some action's going to happen. Mm. James, now, this is the first time of the two times in this movie he uses the old lighter punch trick.
Mm. That's right.
Is this a James Bond, a stalwart James Bond trick? Or
something Pierce Brosnan picked up in a pub in Ireland, I'm sure.
He does it in when he's in Thailand, Hong Kong. That's when he does it again. When Michelle,
he does it in. Aren't they in Singapore?
Singapore, right? Sorry.
Listen, we're all racist.
I had honestly.
We don't know which aged country.
I also watched this movie 2 weeks ago, so that's part of the problem.
Well, I watched it last night.
Oh, geez.
And this morning, finished it this morning.
Can I say though, this is obviously not a favorite of mine. David Arnold's score is fantastic for this movie.
Yeah, I for the most part really really liked the music in the movie, except for maybe including, I enjoyed and hated a couple of parts in the movie where it goes into full-on late-night Showtime mode. Like, there are a couple, like, soprano sax moments in this movie that are bonkers.
He does an interesting thing where, because the movie is mostly in Germany, he goes for a real German techno kind of a score.
I don't know. I was hearing these kind of just Barry references and stuff throughout, and I don't know.
Well, nice. What's interesting is he got criticized they got criticized for not using the James Bond theme enough in GoldenEye.
Yeah, it's in it a ton.
They sort of overdid it here. Yeah. As a response. You know, sometimes that happens. Like, we're responding right now to the fact that we criticize these movies too much.
Right. That's true.
You don't give a shit, because you hate this movie.
I don't... Like I said, I don't hate it. It's just my least favorite Bond movie, and it needs...
Wait a second.
What?
You previously just said it was your least favorite Brosnan movie, so now you're putting this at the bottom of the list
Oh, I meant to say least favorite Bond movie. This is my least favorite James Bond movie.
What the fuck is wrong with you? What? There's so much to like in this movie. There's so many subtle little things to really
enjoy.
You're
going to have to point them out as I go along.
I will point them out. Okay. Right. So, first of all, let's talk about this action sequence. Okay?
Right. Okay.
This action sequence, not terrible.
No,
James Bond has
terrible.
To grab a jet and fly it away.
Yeah. But
and
again,
then there are MiGs
I just hate when just Bond can, he just can fly any jet, you know? Give me, ground me in reality a little bit, or go full Roger Moore.
full Moore.
But, you know.
But I enjoyed this action scene quite a bit when I was a kid. I liked ejecting the guy behind
into
him,
the other
into
plane.
The other
that
plane.
That is so crazy. That's like straight out of Face Off.
Yeah,
exactly.
It's insanity.
Yeah. And it's funny because you could tell they were kind of reacting to movies like that. To your, I don't know specifically the years on all these, but Face Off, The Rock, Mission Impossible 2, all those kind of John Woo-y.
Oh you're right in there. You're right.
Oh, that's why Michelle Yeoh's in this too.
Yeah, that's exactly why Michelle Yeoh's in this. Yeah.
So you could tell that they were trying to, give the kids what they wanted in terms of like crazy kind of goofy action.
Yeah.
So James, sorry, I just unplugged the thing and I'm asking to take it. If you heard a pop at home, that was our fault. So what I enjoy is the firing of the jet engine, of the MiG jet engine, into the shattering of the glass that leads us into the opening credits.
That's right. So now, welcome to Dr. Gorlass's magical song, Molasses, where we go through the alternate options for James Bond theme
songs.
This
is basically my favorite feature on the show.
Well,
I'm glad to be here live for it.
Because this one is bonkers. There are so many because they basically said...
Please say there's one by Korn.
But you're going to get Pulp, Saint Etienne, Swan Lee, Dot Allison, Straw... and then, of course, the K.D. Lang original that plays at the end of the movie. So the producers basically put out a sort of secret contest to songwriters and said, like, we're looking for the next Bond song. Will you submit? And didn't really tell any of the other people that they were doing that. So I think all of these people thought, this is a real option. I'll write this song and do this. And they turned
it in. Oh, and they all thought it was going to be the James Bond song.
And then they
found
out.
80 other people were doing this.
And so I've looked at some interviews with, like, Saint Etienne, and they were like, we didn't know. And Jarvis Cocker from Pulp took his and released it as a single called Tomorrow Never Lies.
Wasn't that the original title of the movie?
Was it?
I think just in my general Wikipedia browsing, the original title was Tomorrow Never Lies, but they faxed it over to MGM and the ink ran, and they thought it was Tomorrow Never Dies, and they just loved that title so much.
Oh my God, I never heard that.
Yeah.
Anyway, so here's Pulp doing Tomorrow Never Lies.
Tomorrow never lies.
It's got a little classy feel to it.
It swings a little bit.
It's a long song, so we won't go through the whole thing. But it is a little...
Really, a long Jarvis Cocker song? That doesn't track.
It is a lazy song. It's just... There we go. Picks up.
So grab your chance, don't let it go. The city streets are littered with casualties.
We'll just go to the hook or the chorus of each of these. And the shit hats and the wood have been... Did he say shit house?
It sounds like a 70s Bowie song, kind of.
Yeah, that's what it does sound like. Yeah. I don't know how Bond it ends up sounding, but... It's very Bowie.
It is very Bowie.
Yeah, I think it probably wasn't the right fit. Okay. So, here comes... Saint Etienne and this little sort of wispy little number. Starts off sounding kind of Bondy and then just It's a little sweet.
Right now, I'm just sort of really hearing why Sheryl Crow's song was picked.
Yeah, none of these will jump out as, oh, they should have done that.
Yeah.
You know,
what the hell were they thinking?
And I also heard them in an interview say, like, I've heard all the other ones. I think ours was the best.
Everyone thinks theirs was the best.
Yeah.
This seems good. This sounds like something that's playing in orchestra.
Yeah.
She just doesn't like, have the voice, you know?
There's also the, there's like a very 70s sounding guitar in the background.
What's your guys' take on Adele's song?
Like it.
We love it.
I also love it.
Yeah.
We love it, right?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
I feel like, yeah, I mean, I feel like that has the kind of, like, sex appeal that you want from one of these songs.
Yeah, it's darkness to it.
Yeah.
Here it is.
And the orchestration, which I think is key in a James Bond song.
Yeah, I feel like
fucking,
maybe just,
I like a
like,
symphony behind it.
That's fair. I feel like in the 90s just maybe weren't that sexy a decade.
No, you're right.
And I feel like maybe all of these styles and singers, like, I don't know, sex appeal went away for a couple years?
Is that... Sex appeal. It may have.
It disappeared.
No one fucked from the years.
Guys, where'd sex appeal go?
This is Swan Lee with Tomorrow Never Dies.
Swan Lee.
Maybe we won't go through all these. They're just very...
That's interesting. Whoa.
I could be wrong, but I'm not sure she ever says Tomorrow Never Dies in this entire...
This sounds like... This sounds like 1997 to me.
Sure.
And they really went for a type, too, other than pulp. Like, they're going for these kind of breathy girl singers.
This sounds like Robin and...
Right.
The Cardigans.
Yeah, the Cardigans. Yeah. They, you know, they might have been able to pull it off, because they were kind of retro-sounding.
Yeah, actually, did you make a mistake? Is this from the soundtrack to The Craft?
No, this is from Singles. No, that wouldn't be right. That would be grungy. Sorry. Oh, I meant Reality Bites. All right.
That all works. This maybe seems the closest to me, though.
Oh, there it is. Tomorrow Never Dies. Okay.
Great.
So this one's going to seem weird, but this is Dot Allison, and I kind of like this song, but not for a Bond song at all.
Boy, they love their intros.
It's called Tomorrow Never Comes. You know what? This may have never been associated with a Bond film, and I just... Someone else...
You just searched Tomorrow Never?
Yeah, because there's so many alternate endings to that phrase. It's very pretty. Very Lilith Fair.
The Lisa Loeb Bond song. That's the one I want to hear.
Yeah.
Because it'll make me think about Lisa Loeb, which I enjoy.
I think it's this Sheryl Crow song that we ended up getting.
Yeah, maybe that is. Yeah, maybe that's the closest thing.
I don't see how this could have started a Bond movie.
Yeah, this isn't like a montage of someone doing heroin. That's what this is for.
Yeah. There's a drag.
It's like for, yeah. Like
I still would take it over that Madonna song, though.
Okay. We've had enough.
All right. So this band, Straw, for all I can gather, just did an album of what we would do for Bond songs. And this is their world. Oh, this is World Is Not Enough. Never mind. All right. And then the last one, of course, is... Sorry, it's coming up.
Ms. Katie Lang.
Yes, Katie Lang. And it's called Surrender, and it was the original title song that David Arnold wrote. And that's why you hear a lot of these themes throughout the movie. Same thing with No Good About Goodbye for Quantum of Solace, that it was then shit-canned and then still left throughout the entire movie. And I think both of those would have been better choices. Here we go. I like this song. You don't like this song.
I don't like it as much.
Oh,
I
love it.
Song.
I love it. Come on.
Right.
Classic.
I mean, that's...
Classic.
Listen to that. Brass.
And then a spaceship took off.
Sure did.
I like this song. I think...
quite a bit.
Matt, the more I think about it, the more I think that the Fiona Apple Bond song is something I would still like to hear. Like, even now, I think that's probably a perfect choice.
Yeah, it, what is that little noise in there that sounds like a predator or something?
Bond turning on his cloaking device.
This one's just, it's ballsy, it's brassy, you know? Ba-ba-ba-ba-bum. The thing I love about David Arnold is he puts in those ba-ba-ba-ba-bups a lot in this movie like John Barry. You know what I'm talking about, Matt? What are you doing, Matt?
I want more information on the song.
On this song?
Yeah,
I mean, this seems like the safe choice. I can see how they would maybe think that this was maybe a little old-fashioned.
Yeah.
Maybe the kids wouldn't react to this.
And I guess they
didn't... Like they would the hip young Sheryl Crow, who the kids love.
I know.
I guess sure.
By kids, I mean moms getting margaritas.
I saw Sheryl Crow... she had... I'm a fan of the Dave Matthews Band. Anyway, she opened for the Dave Matthews Band at Fenway Park. They did two shows back-to-back nights. Her set list was the same set list.
Oh, really?
Nights.
Bullshit.
What if Dave Matthews did a Bond song?
I can't imagine it being great.
Time to kill again.
I don't know what you're trying to do there.
That's my
The producers
my
are like, listen,
Dave
we
Matthews
think
impression.
Bond movies are too high stakes. They need to be more chill. We need a
college
super chill
friendly.
Bond movie.
Yeah.
Well, listen, okay, so now let's talk about the visual aspect of the opening credits.
All right.
I love it. I love the X-ray.
Yeah, that's good.
It's really
good. I like seeing inside the gun, clip go in the gun.
You like seeing inside this very watch right here? It's
you
pretty good, right?
You thought you would have seen it for The World Is Not Enough because there's an X-ray scene.
Yeah,
you know?
But I think what happened was they had so much fun making that opening. They were like, let's make a scene of this.
Yeah, you're probably right.
It is, I mean, it is so like, you know, computers are involved in this. Mm-hmm. Like, look at these circuit boards.
The, guys... Circuit boards, right?
Mm-hmm.
Come on, kids.
Computers,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
future.
Kids like computers.
We're officially in the future.
It is so funny how this is a, you know, this is a movie that has that, like, techno-hacker element to it, but no one mentions the internet ever. The internet is around now, like, right?
You're right, huh?
It's, yeah.
Yeah, I'm surprised it wasn't more of an internet-based movie in some way, if they're going for current.
Yeah.
Know?
So I'll read the entry about the songs. The theme song was chosen through a competitive process. There were 12 submissions, including songs from Swan Lee, Pulp, Saint Etienne, Mark Almond, Sheryl Crow, and David Arnold. Crow's song was chosen for the main titles, while Arnold's song Surrender, performed by Katie Lang, which you're hearing right now, was used at the end titles. Its melody cropping up throughout the film. This was the fourth Bond film to have a different opening and closing songs. Two different versions of the soundtrack album were released, the first lacking music from the second half of the film, and the second lacking the songs. Pulp's effort was retitled Tomorrow Never Lies and appeared as a B-side on their single Help the Aged. Moby created a remake of the original James Bond theme to be used for the movie Oh My God, I Completely Forgot About That.
That's
he also
right.
did a music video.
Yeah, where he was in it, like a tux or something?
Yeah, he was running around.
Oh, Moby.
Very techno-y.
Oh, Moby.
Anyway.
Moby, sit down.
So that's that. So, okay, great. Movie opens.
Yeah, can I say one? Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
Just if you just want one little capsulized moment about my feelings in this movie, it's when Brosnan is in the jet and he's being choked by the guy behind him. Watch his choke acting.
Watch his choke acting. Do you think his choke... So, okay.
His chacting.
That's choking.
So here's the premise of this movie. After the credits are done, we open up on...
many cameos?
The HMS Devonshire, right?
Whatever.
Is it the Devonshire? And that is... God, it's 22 minutes before we see Bond again.
Really? Wow.
The Katie, I'm going to pull the cord on this. We can take that down for a second. Thank you.
Well, while you're plugging in, let's list some of the cameos in this movie that aren't even necessarily cameos, maybe before they're famous. But Julian Fellowes is in this opening scene. He created Downton Abbey. Gerard Butler is one of the sailors on the Navy boat.
Mm-hmm.
Did you catch that? Hugh Bonneville is in it from Downton Abbey. The old German Nazi from Last Crusade is in this movie, too. Did you catch him?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. That's all I got. Anyway, that concludes Matt Gourley's spot, the cameo section. We'll get to Michael G. Wilson when it comes up, because it's coming up right now.
Jeffrey Palmer, also in the movie.
Who's that?
He was the Admiral.
And, oh, Admiral Jowls.
Yes, and he was also in As Time Goes By, which is the show, the sitcom on BBC, right, where he played whose wife? Right. Judy Dench's husband, rather.
He played Judy Dench's husband.
I don't know.
Who played his wife? Judy Dench.
If Judy Dench is your wife, it's hard-pressed for you to not be called
But I
wife
think
yourself.
That's probably very confusing to those at home who were like used to seeing them like that.
Yeah, that would be like seeing Bill Cosby and Felicia
Rashad. Yeah. Although it's fun if you look at it as time goes by, a press photo, and you just imagine that it's Em and the Admiral having a good dinner, having a fun picnic.
Oh.
But they're attractive children.
Yes, indeed.
I think as far as like, you know, resumes go, I think the most interesting thing about this movie, looking at all the participants on Wikipedia, is that the director also directed Stop or My Mom Will Shoot.
Yes.
Holy shit.
Roger I know. Spot his word.
Holy
and Turner and Hooch,
shit.
Too.
Wow.
Can you believe that?
I can't
that?
Believe he didn't cram a dog in this or an old lady or something.
Yeah, I'm surprised there's no, like, wow, you know, reaction shots
that
for animals.
That says a lot to me. That says
That's
a
one
lot
of my,
to me.
One of my favorite episodes of How Did This Get Made is the Stop or My Mom Will Shoot episode.
Really? That's a bananas movie.
It's a fucking, it's crazy.
So, yeah, I mean, like, clearly this is a guy who likes to blend action and comedy in a not always successful mm-hmm. way.
Here's the thing, though. I feel like a lot of it was successful. And I, you know, forgive me if for being, what was this, 97? 14 when this movie came out. Mm. But that's right in the wheelhouse of when you're going to like
you're
this
right.
movie.
That's why I think I like a lot of those Roger Moores.
Yeah.
You know?
But I also like a lot of those Roger Moores. Like,
well, you've got
I can
taste,
come down to your
one time.
I can come down to your level. Join me down here, Matt. Come on. Join me.
So hard. But yeah, on that same note, where you're 14 and like this is in your wheelhouse, I'm 24 and it's in my wheelhouse to hate everything at that age because young men in their 20s are the worst. And so it doesn't – this kind of was doomed in the first place. Brosnan was probably doomed for me in the first place because I'm watching at that point Trainspotting and, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not defending it.
But
I'm
you
saying,
saw Titanic, and I still have never seen Titanic.
I loved Titanic at the time. So I did have some lapses in judgment. I don't know why I couldn't do it for this.
Okay, so let's talk about the premise of this movie. Okay, this is the we talked a little bit about Jonathan Pryce. Jonathan Pryce playing an over-the-top villain who is a media mogul who owns every facet of the media. They call him the Emperor of the Air, which I thought was a great...
He owns everything. Newspapers, magazines, TV.
I want it all.
What's this one other thing where information...
Brick-and-mortar bookstores, 8-tracks, laser discs. I want everything.
Gupta, I want you to buy me Borders Books and Music.
Sam Goody will be mine.
Circuit City. yes. Let's hear a little sample of Jonathan
John
Pryce.
Willis's pager emporium will no longer see.
We're gonna hear a little bit of Jonathan Pryce.
A new Coke that will decimate the old Coke.
Sorry, man.
Imagine Pepsi if it were clear.
You're mad.
Make it so.
You'll kill us all.
I want films. I want TV. I want radio. I want us on the air 24 hours a
radio.
Day. This is our moment. And a billion people around this planet will watch it, hear it, and read about it from the Carver Media Group.
Okay, pause it. Here's my problem. Okay.
Look at his face.
I know. I'm actually not complaining about his acting. Yeah. It's his choices, I think, because he has to play this nutball. He's a psychotic nutball, and he's facing a screen full of people who are probably no doubt involved in dubious affairs. But for him to deliver it to those people that way, even those people would go, shit, I got a lot riding on this. I'm invested in this. Is a crazy man. I'm pulling out. He should be selling it to them rationally, you know?
Yeah, I think that's the thing that makes this movie such a goofball movie. It's not necessarily this premise, which is, you know, which is fine. You can do a version of this that, you know, that makes sense.
Yeah.
This does not make sense.
No, I want those people on the screens to be looking at each other Brady Bunch style, but like, what's this guy doing?
But he is just, he is so evil. He's never not evil.
I know.
He never like appeals to the rational.
Exactly.
Or
that's
the...
interesting that you say that he's never not evil, because there are moments with a lot of the other villains, either with, you know, even something as little as Blofeld petting his cat.
Exactly.
You know, where there is some sort of humanity in there.
What it is pure, well, you have action drama, and then this is pure melodrama. He's a pure villain, and there's no goodness, and Bond is, you know, basically pure good, even though he's an anti-hero. And it becomes uninteresting because there's no dimension to him, you know?
Yeah, but there is one dimension, and it's bonkers.
Yeah,
it's a fun dimension, but you need something to set it against.
Well, let's hear how this man meets with people.
Okay. Oh God.
Phase 2 is underway. I have the videotape.
Sexy Teddy.
I haven't seen it myself, but I'm told.
I like how his muscle guy, his thug, is also like in charge of tech stuff.
I know.
Like, this guy just does everything.
Yeah.
His thug is also a boat captain. He's like a naval captain.
He can also pilot the stealth boat.
You can guarantee there were two characters combined into one for that.
And ladies.
Also, like, he serves him his meals. He's just an all-purpose thug.
I do. Here's the thing, though. I do like... and I will say this. There's something to this movie now, watching it 15 years later. Just something about his plan is to launch a new network. But he wants the perfect news story to go with it, so he decides to make it.
Boy, and you know, this is so tone deaf to what people watch on TV. Like,
sure.
You would think that, like, if he was being realistic, like, to inflame passions and to get people to, you know, to deify his network, he would do something like, he would be planning, like, we should convince people that they're trying to outlaw Christmas. That's right. We'll construct a war on Christmas. Like international affairs don't get the public riled up like this. Yeah. They just don't.
But yeah. World War III might.
That's true. It is so extreme.
But
that,
this is him...
Who was pointing out on Twitter something that he... Who said this? It was brilliant. He basically has an iPad right there, and if he would just develop that, he would be so much more successful. I'm sorry to whoever you were. It was brilliant, and I wish I could credit you.
Very. So here he is. He pulls up a bunch of 4x3 screens.
This, Justin, by a curious quirk of fate, we have the perfect story with which to launch our satellite news network tonight. It seems
I do
a small
like this
crisis
he,
is brewing in the
he
South
is,
China.
He's going for
having
it.
A fucking yeah. blast.
I want full newspaper
it's
coverage.
Sexual in a
I
weird
want magazine
way.
Stories.
But he's like, he has a weird breathing
thrones.
Rhythm he's
I
developed
TV.
For the character,
I want radio.
Too.
I want us on the air 24 hours a day. This is our moment. And a billion
now
people
we obviously
around
just
this
heard this,
planet.
But I like him checking in on his various companies to see how devious they're being.
Yeah. Let's just get a daily evil check.
It's the worst.
There's no news. Like bad news.
He's really going for it.
Oh my God.
You gotta like that performance.
I do, but it just. Oh.
I know. The script is so stupid.
Now, here's where we start. This is my favorite chunk of this movie.
Okay.
The next 10 minutes of this movie. Here we are outside Oxford University. Okay, James Bond is in there. How do we know he's in there? Well, sure, you hear some audio up top, but you also see the Aston Martin DB5 parked out front, which lets you know that that's his car. He's driving that. He's still driving that. He had it in Goldeneye. He's driving
it
in this.
Yeah, you see him driving to MI6.
Oh, wait, have they
too, right?
Did they do the part where they talked about they're going to release the president's sex tape?
Yes.
Release it anyway.
Consider him slimed. Yes. The guy says,
consider him slimed.
Michael
G. Wilson.
Yeah.
We're in a world where the president has a sex tape out, but no one's talking about that. Like,
I know.
That's actually, know. That seems to me to be the better plan almost. Like, that's more disruptive to the world than this, you know,
this skirmish
no
between
fly
China.
Zone with China.
Yeah. If you watch Ronan and Jonathan Pryce's performance in that is the polar opposite. So it's not like the guy's not a versatile actor. You know, he probably was directed this way by this guy who directed Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. Because what you're seeing here is probably what he was telling Sylvester Stallone at the time. You know?
This is the first of two. This is the first of two in this movie.
What he couldn't get Sylvester Stallone to do, he took out on someone that could do it. And he's like, finally, I can get someone to do this shit I want. And Jonathan Pryce was like, I can do it. Do you want it? Should you? It's the same thing with building a nuclear bomb. Just because you can, it doesn't mean you should.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you guys have talked about the Brosnan movies and tone issues a lot, and I think it's right on, and I think this movie is a great example of them wanting it both ways, of them wanting a kind of campy, you know, romp, but also something that's a little more serious, and it just doesn't always fit.
We had some issues with Skyfall, but I think it is maybe what Skyfall gets right. It's the reverse version of it, so this is too much drama followed by too much comedy, and Skyfall has a lot of drama with some good little moments of humor and camp and stuff like that. Yeah.
Well, it's like you're running, this movie's like running with an elastic behind your back, and then as soon as you get to the most dramatic or whatever part, it swings you back the other direction.
It's too pendulous, yeah.
Yeah, it brings you back to this fucking, like, crazy, like, line or character.
Yeah.
But this is the first of two. There's two scenes in this movie which I refer to as British offs.
Oh, I'm in.
There are two British offs in this movie where you have three English character actors attempting to see
who could be the stuffiest,
the most British.
Oh, God.
And I just want to play a little bit of the first British off, which happens in MI6.
It was an unprovoked attack on a ship in international waters. We send in the fleet for recovery and prepare for full retaliation.
Moderation. We investigate and stop short of sending the entire British Navy within 10 minutes of the world's largest air force.
When will our ships be in position?
48 hours.
Christ. Chris, we're already screaming for blood. The last thing
that's
we want to do is escalate.
She should do a spit take with tea, right? Yeah. She should do a spit take with her afternoon tea.
Here's
17 British sailors murdered. According to Vietnamese officials who recovered the bodies, the victims were riddled with the same ammunition used by the Chinese Air Force.
Did you use this?
Well, it was an M60, so no, it wasn't.
It's the first I've heard of it.
Well, this settles it. We sent in the fleet. M, you have 48 hours to investigate.
He won.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He absolutely. Julian Fellow.
You have 48 hours to investigate.
He was actually in a cricket uniform all the time. Yes. That we should point out. He was great.
Actually, every time they cut to him, he was surrounded by lawn. It was weird.
Yeah.
But this is the only time. This is a fun little bit of trivia, and I could be wrong about this, but I think this is the only time you see Pierce Brosnan in a 3-piece suit.
Really?
Dude. Yeah.
I love when you and I both do this. We sometimes
say a fact and then go, well, I could be wrong.
Yeah. But also, we would like to reiterate that this is not a journalist podcast.
Mm-mm.
We don't.
There's little to no journalism going
or
on.
Or facts.
Yeah.
Most of the shit we're just making up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the phenomenon of the
Did
British...
Did you know Lou Ferrigno was a Bond for 6 movies?
That's amazing. Yeah. I wasn't aware of that. I'll have to check Wikipedia. No,
those were the musical Bonds, right?
Yeah. Oh, they were great.
So we've left British off number one, and now we're heading over to one of my favorite scenes.
Okay, I like this scene.
In all of the James Bonds.
I do like this scene, and yeah.
They're under a time crunch.
Yeah.
So how the fuck are they going to do this? He's got to fly out of there immediately. So they hop in a fucking Rolls Royce with a police escort, and they are bombing around.
Oh, God, this is the...
Drinking liquor
innuendo
in the worst place to be drinking liquor. Yeah.
Did they learn nothing from Princess Di? She hadn't died yet, had she?
We found our sailors 3 hours ago.
How'd they get the paper out so fast?
Somebody at Tomorrow knew before the Vietnamese government did.
How much do you know about Elliot Carver, 007?
Worldwide media baron. Able to topple governments with a single broadcast. Carver owns that newspaper Tomorrow.
I didn't want to discuss it in front of the minister, but that mysterious signal came from one of Carver's satellites. PM would have my head if he knew you were investigating him. I'm sending you to Hamburg, 007. We've arranged for you to be invited tonight
Handed
to a party
fucking
at Carver's
dossier,
Media
yeah.
Center.
Being told what
he's
doing.
Celebrating the launch of a new satellite.
It's got good urgency.
Now
I like
has
this
the ability
scene.
To reach every human being on the Earth.
Money pennies up front.
Except the Chinese.
They found make a couple of pussy
rights.
Eating jokes before you get up
but
the bus.
James, she hands
your
him
ticket, cover story, and rental car reservation.
Yeah, it's good.
Sign here, please.
I'm dying for that.
I
again.
Believe you once had a relationship with Carver's wife.
Look at what's happening in this movie you hate.
That was a
no,
long
I like
time ago.
I like this. It's the problem
before
is it sets
married.
Itself up to be great.
I didn't realize it was public knowledge.
Just takes
Queen
a massive
country,
British shit.
Your job is to find out whether Carver or someone in his organization
love
set
I love
that ship
this
off
scene.
Course
she's got fucking
Use your
scotch.
Relationship with Mrs. Carver if necessary.
I doubt if she'll remember me.
remind her. Then pump her for information.
That's the way you do it.
How much pumping is needed, James?
It
is only ever true of you and I, Moneypenny.
Now that he's gotten his dossier, his mission dossier, where is he headed now? What's the next scene?
Is it not Denmark or something?
Oh, no. Yeah, if he goes to Germany.
Yeah.
And who does he have to go see first?
The lady.
The quartermaster.
Oh.
Now he immediately sees Q. Oh. Again, this is exactly what we want in a James Bond movie. Yeah,
who works at true. Avis?
Oh, yes. Yes. This is product right. placement for Avis. Yeah.
Mein Büro hat 9 Auto Reserviate.
Ridiculous. Yeah. Come on.
Now, this is Desmond Llewellyn's second to last appearance in the movie. Now, let's
I mean,
hear
I
this.
I think we're used to product placement in Bond movies
sure.
at this point. Mm-hmm. There's the watches, there's
there
the BMWs,
been, yeah.
but them having such a pedestrian brand like Avis, and later I think we mentioned he's doing shots of Smirnoff at some point.
Yeah. But in fairness to James in this movie,
sure.
In Dr. No. The man's drinking Smirnoff.
I feel like after this Avis scene, he has to go to a State Farm kiosk and get
insurance.
Rental insurance. And but it is Desmond Llewellyn's second to last movie. Let's put him in a real dignified sport coat.
If you just sign here, Mr. Bond.
This is great. I love it when Q goes undercover
the insurance
and has to meet him in the field.
Work at an airport. It'd be funny if he worked at Cinnabon the next time he came to the airport.
Is it in coverage?
Yes.
Fire?
Probably.
Property destruction?
Definitely.
Personal injury?
I hope not, but accidents do happen.
They frequently do with you.
Well, that takes care of the normal wear and tear. Do I need any other protection?
Only from B007, unless you bring that car back in pristine
Pierce
order.
Pierce Brosnan doesn't
Shall
seem...
We?
Shall we?
Doesn't seem conscious of when what he's saying comes off like a sexual innuendo. He seems like he's trying to fuck this old man. Throughout this whole scene, I'm like...
Go back and play it
wear
again.
Wear and tear on your pussy
it.
That I'm about to...
Well, what he's doing is over-the-top acting of checking, looking at his blazer. That's what he's doing.
I want to watch it with the understanding that he's trying to have sex with Q.
We're sorry we're replaying this, audience.
Just the insurance damage waiver for your
Brosnan,
beautiful new car.
Here we go.
British fob.
Will you need collision coverage?
Yes.
It's the
fire?
Looks.
Yeah.
Probably.
Property destruction?
Definitely.
Personal injury?
I hope not, but accidents do happen.
Oh my God,
I might accidentally fuck you.
Look at him, he's locking him over.
Takes care
oh
of the
God, that's
wear
so
and tear.
Yeah, it's like Pierce Brosnan, like, it's like, oh yeah, Bond, he's sexy, right? He's a sexy guy, but like, no, not all the time.
Yeah.
Not to everyone.
Yeah. Now,
to
that,
women, to beautiful
that
women.
That was Moore's take on it. I've
now,
got mine.
From the ages of 14 to probably 22 years old, this BMW 750 was the car I wanted the most.
Mm. Oh, wow. Yeah, I was going to ask, so something that I never really connected with in the Bond movies. Like, I've never been like a stuff guy.
Yeah,
I've never been a guy
either.
Who covets, you know, watches and cars and suits and stuff.
You mean you're
like
not
that.
Materialistic like Matt?
I don't think it's materialism. I think it's a love of the finer things. But yeah, so I was kind of wondering when I saw this car if this was a car that Bond fans liked.
No.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
It's not because it's a sedan.
And the and the BMW thing I think was such a blip on his radar. It felt more marketed.
It was very marketed.
Yeah.
Although I do vividly remember the commercials they had for the BMW Z3, which was a British court. The commercial was a British court. And they were charging...
like people with powdered wigs?
They were powdered wigs, barristers, the whole thing. they were charging James Bond with driving a BMW. And then nothing happens in the courtroom. And then they say, on the wrong side of the road. And then everyone gasps.
Was there a James Bond character in the commercial? Or?
No, but it was a tie-in with GoldenEye.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Wow.
But this is a BMW 750 IL. That's the long wheelbase. That's what the L stands for in the IL, okay?
Oh, okay.
They still make a 750, but it's now the LI. The L comes first. I don't know why. The naming scheme changed
in
2003.
What does the I stand for?
the eye technology, you know, the BMW's got there's a bunch of eyes, the 328i, it's just in their naming scheme. So the 750iL, this car I thought was fucking amazing. So this car, if you were to buy this brand new back then, no one cares about this but me, but this is about $120,000.
Oh my God.
For this sedan.
You're kidding.
Yeah, loaded.
Because it's remote control?
No. But a loaded BMW 750 is going to run you up into the hundreds.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Even, what is it today? What would that be today?
They're still about 115, 120. I think the base price is like 87,000 or something like that.
Are you serious? Yeah. I had no idea.
So when you see one of these on the road.
Your new BMW 750. All the usual refinements. Machine guns, rockets, the GPS tracking system.
Now it just looks like Pierce Brosnan, that you put that in my head, wants to fuck that car.
He wants to fuck everything.
Welcome. Please fasten seatbelt and obey all instructions for a safe trip.
Thought you'd pay more attention to a female voice.
You randy old devil.
I am not interested in your sordid escapades. Let's
Forgets
get
which
on
pocket
with it,
he put the cell phone in.
Your new telephone. Talk here, listen here.
So that's what I've been doing wrong all these years.
Look, it also includes a fingerprint scanner and a 20,000-volt security system, and this I'm particularly proud of. The remote control for your car. Tap twice.
I had that cell phone.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Now, draw your finger very slowly across the pad to drive the car.
I do like when he backs it into the.
Well,
it's a 5-liter V12
drive,
has
but,
in that car. It's a
really?
Fucking so much horsepower in that thing.
I love
what do you
that
know about his
not
overcoat,
good at it,
Matt?
That's a Brioni overcoat.
Okay, don't ask.
Great,
don't ask.
Great.
Brioni suits. The Brioni was the suit maker for Pierce Brosnan through Casino Royale. He made Daniel Craig's first suits, and then they switched to Tom Ford.
How do you feel about that?
The Tom Fords are great. They're a little more expensive than the Brionis.
Okay,
but you know they're a great suit.
Welcome to our session we call Fashion Chat, where we check in with Matt Mary. He tells us the thread count of any sort of camel mohair wool.
Why is the announcer for my own show pronouncing my last name wrong?
Well, part of the problem is I drink, I have a stutter, a bit of a neural problem. And
it was nice of you to hire him, Matt.
Yeah, well, yeah.
He clearly needs the job. He has a lot of problems.
I got to do what I can do.
I go right from here to the curb.
I love, and if you're getting this episode a little later than normal, it's because we're recording it today.
That's right. It was a busy week.
And also, we've already gone a really long time, and we are 29 minutes into the movie.
Well, my notes stop. They just fall off precipitously as I just
I think
just
I find that with most of the James Bond movies. So, okay. So, guys, let's talk about the very quickly, thoughts on the car. Matt Gourley.
None.
No thoughts on the car.
The BMW doesn't work for me. Give me back the Aston Martin or give me cake.
No comment on
what that means.
No.
Oh, the remote, the whole thing.
No comment on like how stocked it was, how much gadgets it had.
I've never been one for the car full of things, even the Aston Martin. Like I liked it maybe once in Goldfinger and maybe the Lotus, but I don't think it needs to be redone anymore. You know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a scene that I really like, something I kind of enjoyed watching was all the thugs trying to break into the car.
Yeah, that's fun.
And not being able to do it. That was kind of surprisingly comical to me.
Yeah.
And
It's good prop acting by those guys with sledgehammers.
Oh, absolutely. I'll have to look for that.
But it seems like something happens, and it's part of the action scene that the windows get blown out. So because he can duck, and like a rocket goes through the broken window and hits another car. A cool moment, but how did those windows get broken? If those thugs couldn't break them, it seems like they
were shooting
shattered.
At them.
It seems like they just get shattered randomly.
There you
at
go,
some
guys.
Point.
You're finding holes in your own movie. There you go. When they in For Your Eyes Only, when he has that really souped up car in the beginning, and the guys hit it with their rifle butts, and it blows up.
Yeah,
that was John Glenn saying, "We've gone too far with these cars. Let's just blow this thing up." And he has to go in this little French. What is it? That
Citroen.
Citroen. And
yeah.
I feel like okay, there we're done. You know, and then this comes back around.
So, all right. So he gets the car from Q. We've seen Q.
Yeah.
So far we've seen the bad guy's plan.
Mm-hmm.
Mission has been established. He's been given a dossier.
Yeah.
He's flown to a location. He's met Q. Uh-huh. He's got his car. He's got his gadgets. He's ready to go. Already everything we want from a James Bond movie.
Sure.
And somehow this is still your least favorite James Bond movie.
Yeah.
Did you not see the dossier, Matt?
I did.
What did you think of the dossier?
He handed it. Physical paper, on paper.
Sure.
Listen, the standard formula does not a good James Bond movie make.
He got his passport, he got his cover story,
I'm with you.
And he got his rental car reservation.
All the more reason I don't like this movie for setting it up to be a good James Bond movie
and crashing hard.
I would be kind of curious to hear where you think it takes the turn. Like, is there something that happens where you're like, now I can't even give this a chance?
I think right when Carver's giving his big speech and it's just so melodramatic that... And then the other thing that I have a big problem with is, it's coming up, is when Paris and Bond meet and he says, did I get too close? Or she says, did I get too close? And he says, yes. And they're setting it up like she's almost this Tracy character, this love of his life, and yet you have no history of it, you have no sense of what that is, and you're supposed to take it on faith and feel bad that when she dies it's really big for him, but they give you nothing, and it just feels like there's another tone shift when you go from that to You Always Were a Cunning Linguist, or is that the other movie?
No, this has cunning linguists.
Earlier with the Danish, when he's brushing up on a little Danish.
Screw.
And then here's a joke I don't understand in that moment. He's like, I'm brushing up on a little Danish, and she says, what do you mean, little? I don't know. I'm like,
what do you mean, Danish?
I'm sorry.
My vagina
I'm fucking a huge Danish woman.
Huge.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it seems like something a guy would say to, like, when you insulted his dick.
Yeah.
Like, if she was saying, I'm brushing up on a little British.
a little British.
And he says, what do you mean, little? But it's like, I don't know. Do women want to be called large?
No.
Do they not like being called small?
I don't know.
Guys, I don't understand broads, huh?
Who does?
So let's hear a little bit of Terry Hatcher. Again, every interview you saw with Terry Hatcher and Michelle Wie was them saying how their Bond girls were different from other Bond girls.
Every Bond girl
gets convinced that their Bond girl is different from other Bond girls.
And the only ones that have been are
Tracy and Vesper,
right?
End of story. Everyone else is interchangeable.
Maybe you can make the argument that Camille from Quantum of Solace is, because she doesn't sleep with him,
and she does in the shower.
No, that's.
I'm sorry. Severin. I'm thinking of Skyfall. Yeah. Yes, Camille, because she's just out for revenge and doesn't fuck him.
Yeah,
she's the most different.
Maybe. Well, they kiss and she almost kind of pulls away from him. You know, like I'm not gonna mess this guy's. I thought I was damaged.
Yeah.
Jesus. This guy's head looks like an old
attic. As far as, like, Bond babes go,
I think horses in it. Sorry. I went away. It's been a rough week.
As Bond babes go, one of the most memorable ones to me is the redhead that he has that little affair with in Quantum of Solace, and they end up, like, dunking her in oil.
Yeah.
Anyway, as far as, like, Bond babes that I remember my jaw dropping a little bit over, she's definitely... one of the top.
As far as you found the most attractive?
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Oh.
Okay.
But I know she's
good,
a non-character.
Very good
She's a
answer.
Non-character there
yeah.
just
very
to
good answer.
Motivate him.
Matt and I believe we agree on this, besides Lana Wood, who I just put in her own little category.
I like Lana Wood, too.
Yeah. It's Thunderball's guy.
Fiona Volpe.
Fiona Volpe,
I think,
is the best.
She's amazing.
She's in the most boring movie,
but
she's the most fun to look at.
I just love her character, though, too, her acting in Mr. Bond, James Bond. she's just great all around.
Terry Hatcher's easy on the eyes.
Sure,
she's got very 90s hair in this.
She's a good actress in this, too. But
14-year-old me jerked off to her without her dress on like nobody's business.
Maybe my favorite Terry Hatcher thing that's ever happened is in Tango and Cash, where she works at the quintessential non-sexy 80s strip club. The strip club where nothing sexy happens.
So Jumbo's Clown Room.
So yeah, basically Jumbo's Clown Room. I feel like in the 80s, like they had such weird ideas of what went on in a strip club, but it's nothing enjoyable. It's all these costumes and pageantry, but no
or
real
shootouts.
Nudity.
And it was hard not to sit on cocaine.
Right, exactly. So Terry Hatcher is at the non-sexy 80s strip club. She's dancing. She's looking good.
Yeah.
The guys are hooting and hollering. They love it. And then she motions to the bartender, who tosses her two drumsticks. Out comes octagonal drum pads.
What?
And she does a fucking drum solo in a strip club. It's amazing.
that's go home and watch that material. Right?
Yeah. Yep.
Harry Thatcher.
Come on, you're out with your dudes, you're having some drinks, and you're fucking watching Terry Hatcher do a drum solo. She's standing up.
Let's hear a little bit of this different Bond girl situation here.
Bond exhales shakily was the...
Now I know.
Closed caption.
Was it something I said?
How about the words, I'll be right back?
Oh, I take it back about the acting.
This is Terry Hatcher at the height of her powers.
Something always came up.
And how are you, Paris?
Much better now. We're even.
Something to drink, Miss Carver?
Mr. Bond will have a vodka martini, shaken, not stirred.
Mrs. Carver will have a tequila. Straight shot.
Party girl.
No. Mrs. Carver will have a glass of Mr. Carver's champagne.
Mmm. So this is the...
I've changed, James.
That's the worst writing. I'm sorry, but this movie is full of exposition, and then they don't give you any exposition
also,
on what happened with them.
Here's the thing James Bond does.
Yeah.
In most movies that annoys the fuck out of me. He always tips his hand.
Mm-hmm.
So, for instance, in this little conversation he has with the villain...
I did my roommate in Zurich.
He will say, watch, I'll just let this go.
I'm thinking of getting Weylin behind a news desk.
That's wonderful. I'm sure she won't resist too much.
What?
Yeah, that's an odd remark.
And tell me earlier, I was just wondering about your satellites, the way you've positioned yourself globally.
Are they merely tools for information, Mr. Bond?
Or disinformation. Say if you wanted to manipulate the course of governments, or people, or even a ship.
Boy. Right.
Oh, by the way, I know exactly what you did, and I'm here to stop you.
But yeah, there is something.
But then he says one more thing. Here we go. Taunting.
You have a vivid imagination for a banker. Perhaps I should commission you to write a novel.
Oh, heavens no, I'd be lost at sea. Adrift.
Here, I'll
just like a sunken British ship who everyone thinks the Chinese sunk, but they didn't.
I like this. Bond does this throughout the movies, and it's kind of that Hamlet do the play to Claudius, similar to his father's murder, to see if he looks guilty. Like, sure. I feel like he's trying to get his goat to see if it riles him a lot, which I kind of like.
It seems like you would start small with mad cow disease thing.
Yeah.
Maybe don't go into the... international.
Like, why didn't you just say the date it happened?
Mad cow disease, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease.
Yeah,
sure.
That's the name of it. So here we are at this party. Tips his hat. He knows the satellite thing. We meet Weylin. She's delightful. Then there's a scene of James Bond getting the shit kicked out of him for a bit, and then he turns the tables.
Mm-hmm.
And I enjoy that scene, too. You don't like that.
Well, I mean, yeah. This movie is only set pieces, though. That's all this movie is. I don't feel like there's any drama worth watching in this movie. So some of the set pieces are pretty cool. But that's all it is to me. And all it ever will be.
I love also how quickly Carver fires his stage manager.
Yeah.
But
that's another thing. I feel like anybody with any common sense can see that this guy is unstable. And how did he build an empire? Who would work with this man?
Stage manager. So do you like that Bond just turns off? I like that Bond just turns the power off.
Yeah, that's nice.
A very Bondian.
Yeah, he just turns the switch from on to off.
Yeah, he turns,
and that destroys his whole.
I can see Daniel Craig's Bond doing that, or Connery.
No, I don't know what that says, but anyway. It says something, and my computer is obviously not being cooperative right now. So
they can't see the little spinning wheel.
At this point, he's been beaten by thugs. He knows that they're on to him somehow. How did they know what he was there to do?
Yeah, he didn't tip his hat in any way.
I don't understand what's happening. So he has to go tuck his tail between his legs, head to his hotel room, and then do the whole, I'm going to be like Dr. No, James Bond, and I'm going to sit here with a bottle of Smirnoff, put a silencer on my gun, sit in my chair, and just wait. The only thing that was missing was cards for him to play solitaire with.
Yeah.
That thing's not coming back. I think we lost it, everybody.
No.
So this is when he runs back and waits, and Paris arrives. Terry Hatcher.
She's pregnant during the making of this movie.
Is she?
Yes.
Well, let me tell you. She looks great.
Yeah.
Do I have a new fetish? I don't know.
Maybe.
Pregnant women, huge hair.
Pregnant women, huge
hair. Type that into your porn search engine.
So then we see a scene after this of Carver watching the news coverage of his blackout.
Mm-hmm.
And that reporter going,
oh, no, yes, yes. Oh, no, that's that part is so goofy. That part is so goofy. So he's watching the news coverage of the blackout, and the guy from the rival news station, which looks like just a fucking local newscast. It looks just like, you know, this is Poughkeepsie's 6 o'clock news. He just like, don't worry, Mr. Carver, we didn't do it. That's what sets him off. Like, there's nothing more cutting that guy can say. It's the most minor barb.
I want to play it.
No one that insecure could have built this empire.
Yeah, that's what sets him off. Just that fucking yokel from Butte, Montana going, we didn't do it.
Sorry, Elliot. We didn't do it. I can't play it because my computer's being a dick.
And now, and now Simpsons reruns. Like,
then there's the long, meaningless scene with Terry Hatcher. I found the whole rekindling. I found that to be
you gotta earn it.
There's a movie convention there that I noticed.
Yes, I'm listening.
Where, so he's, you know, they're staring intently at each other. They kiss. She undoes the back of her dress.
Oh yeah.
Lets it fall.
Oh yeah, she does.
And then they gaze into each other's eyes and start to kiss again. I feel like that is so unrealistic to foreplay. I feel like as a man, as soon as the boobs come out, you just turn into like
an animal,
like a cat with a beanbag.
Yeah.
Like however long.
Yep.
Like that becomes the focus.
Yeah.
Of like, I don't know if I could keep eye contact.
Well, that's the test. If you can keep eye contact, I also woman knows you love her.
By the way, this little exchange between Gupta and
Law
Jonathan Pryce.
Law of creative anomalies.
Is this the doctor send
it
the doctor?
It sounds too good to be true. Yeah. It always is.
Do you think my wife knows?
Yes, Carver, she does. She told you.
Garbage, but if
she told you that she knows him and said, what was her cover? That she, that
no,
James
he,
dated.
He asking if, he, yeah. if she knows.
But James dated her roommate in Zurich.
Yeah.
That's her cover, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this
noise.
Line that she delivers here, tell me, James, you still
keep sleep with a gun under your bed.
That would fit her cover story just fine.
Yeah.
Like her roommate would be like, this guy I'm dating, you know James, right?
Sleeps with a gun under his pillow.
Watch this.
I think we should set an appointment for my wife with the doctor.
Do you think the Ricky J role was originally offered to Kevin Smith? I could see that, huh?
Yeah, sure.
Tell me, James, do you still sleep with a gun under your pillow?
Because my roommate in Zurich told me about that odd quirk that you had.
As he walks out the room.
Yeah. No, what?
Forget it.
Too far.
Kill your wife. It's too far to walk.
Yeah.
I've delivered my greatest
I'm not a thin man.
I'm not about to take it back.
So then now we see the scene of James breaking into the Carver building to get the GPS back.
Mm-hmm.
The GPS.
See, well, how do you feel about that scene?
I'll tell you how I feel.
Cranky Matt.
A set piece can only be so good if there's no emotional investment, and I'm just gone by this point. I don't know what it is.
Where'd you go?
Well, here's also the problem.
Yes, it can, Matt. You telling me you don't enjoy the Transporter films?
Is that what you're saying?
Are you saying you don't like the Transporter movies?
This podcast is over.
I don't know. I think because it's just like this is a kid that's just not studying, you know? You want it. It's smart. It's a smart kid, but it's not doing well on its tests, and you want to go, come on, Junior. You're better than this.
But, Dad, I'm trying.
Is this the...
Are you really trying? I think maybe you're phoning
All the words look backwards on the page.
Yeah, see?
Oh, you've been dyslexic this whole time.
What?
Junior, here's the problem. Is
this the shortest
time
between Bond movies? Because this was like a year after GoldenEye, right? Or 2 years?
It was 2 years.
2 years.
Is that... That's, I mean, that's pretty short.
For a later Bond film,
yeah, because they got into the fantasticness of the 95, 97, 99, 2001. And then... Waited a long time.
Casino Royale and Quantum of Solace were 2 years apart.
Yep. And they were going to do that again, but then now they're like, well, we can't do that. Sam Mendes is like, I can't make a movie that fast.
Yeah.
Whatever. Yes, you can. American Beauty. How long did that take? 5 weeks?
7 years.
So you don't enjoy the... him breaking into this place. I also... I like the exposition of the satellite... It's worth $300 million. If you break,
you break it, you bought it.
Yeah.
And then James, for no reason, just knocks it over. Mm. Knocks over the set piece that looks like it's made of paper mache.
Yeah.
Like it looks like it's paper mache.
And why is the satellite in his office?
Yeah. Also, yeah, that should be in a clean room somewhere. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so he... Yep. All right, so this is when he runs into Weylin. They're both doing the job. She runs down the thing. He says, my favorite Pierce Brosnan... put down is right after he throws this guy.
Oh, this is a fun line.
Right now they're fighting over
the newspaper.
They're at
factory.
The newspaper factory. They're at the printing press.
Yeah.
And he is about to get thrown off thing into a bunch of newspaper. Love it. I don't see how you have a problem with this.
Another Avis employee.
Yep.
Avis rental car. Some of our guys are evil.
Broken arm, punch in the nose, knocks over into the... Immediately starts shooting blood.
Yeah.
Here we go.
They'll print anything these days.
Huh?
Said to no one.
Huh? He does it for him, Jordan. He does it for him.
He does it for us, the audience.
This is the worst movie ever made.
you're
very, come on, that's a pretty good one-liner as far as one-liners go.
This. I don't know what it's going to take to make you see this.
I think because...
Do I have to liquor you up and then make you watch it in the theater?
I don't know. Say what you will about Lazenby and Dalton. Their bond
before you say anything, his is just a rehash of everything.
Brosnan is his rehash of everything. There's
what I was trying to get you to stop saying was that, because before you, there's only one James Bond who lives in Malibu and is close enough to come on this podcast, and his name is Pierce Brosnan.
I would be petrified if he did for all of the horrible things I've said. And let
Pierce
me reiterate
Brosnan, come
again.
On this podcast, but do not listen to any episodes.
He's also the one Bond that's likely to listen to this, I think. I love the man
as Brosnan.
A man and as an actor. Otherwise, I really like him. It's just not my Bond. I don't know.
I don't know if any of this is Brosnan's fault necessarily. I think that the people producing the series just didn't have a clear vision for it. And, you know, it's like they didn't hire visionary directors to direct these. These
more
are
than anyone,
hired guns.
More than any James Bond, his scripts suffer from tonal shifts.
Yeah.
Sure.
More than everybody else.
But so does his acting. It really does.
I think he's doing a good job of meeting the script. Like meeting what the script wants from him.
Yeah. It would be interesting to see him in one of the darker ones, you know.
But yeah, I mean if we are looking at this as, you know, James Bond through the lens of the 90s action movie, I mean, look at all those classic 90s action movies. Those are tonal fucking patchwork quilts.
I
mean, if you
watch,
doing
it better than this, you know, that's the problem.
Is Face Off a better movie?
Not
than
that.
This,
I'm not that, but
Face Off is
like Die Hard is what Bond should have.
Oh,
been,
sure. I mean, I think Die Hard's obviously.
They do another thing that we love.
Yeah,
We've both been on the record of loving. They bring back a friendly character from a previous movie.
Yeah.
Joe Don Baker.
Even though
the world's greatest B movie actor, Joe Don Baker.
Why not put Felix Leiter in here? Who's this guy?
He's
Wade.
Wade. Yeah.
I like that he's a cartoonish American.
Yeah.
Like he's what the rest of the world thinks America
this
is.
This is the Brosnan era in a nutshell. Everything is shorthand, though. You know. Melodramatic.
Sure, it's all simplified.
Yeah,
everything.
Yeah.
Sure.
I don't know. Those look like two legs on that. Have you seen that in the helicopter?
I guess I mainly know Joe Don Baker from his Mr. Science Theater movies that he's always.
What the hell are you doing here, Jimbo? You know the world's my office. Let's go this way.
Did Q bring you up to speed and everything?
Yeah, I brought along the GPS calibration unit. Oh, by the way, you know that officially, Uncle Sam is completely neutral in this turkey shoot.
And unofficially?
We have no interest in seeing World War III unless we start it. Dr. Greenwald.
It's true.
Oh, God. Yeah.
It's true.
Commentary,
GPS
guys.
Expert.
Commentary.
Sorry about all the security, but the GPS encoder is
That's
one
right,
of the
GPS.
Most closely guarded secrets
they
of the
US government is
military.
Basically just
Jordan,
an iPhone.
What you got?
Jesus,
they've concocted a program that can recognize songs and tell you the title.
Also, another thing that Matt and I are on record is loving, which again, I'm trying to show you how this movie is great.
I hope you know I'm open. I'm listening. I'm just not convinced.
What is he wearing right now?
He's
wearing his naval
uniform. I like that too, but the problem is I feel like they're doing it just
Like, no, just they're doing it because he's on a military base. Whenever he goes on a military base on an official job, he wears his fucking military uniform.
Okay.
So he travels with it. You know what that means? He travels with it.
All right.
It's probably hanging in the back of that BMW at all times, just in case he has to go on official business.
Well, I mean, you know, it's a funny picture.
Pick it up in Hamburg yesterday morning.
Him looking dignified next
something.
To Joe Don Baker's Aloha shirt and Cheetos.
That's the worst, too. He's a CIA guy, so he's got to be, yeah, in a Hawaiian shirt.
He's very reminiscent of the Felix's boss in Quantum of Solace.
Kind of like putting a magnet beside. Oh yeah,
mustache guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh sure.
Yeah. He's trying to do the backdoor deal.
That's a fun character.
I love that guy. Yeah. I love that guy. I wish he'd come back.
I want Felix Leiter to come back.
I do too.
I love it. See, they look him up and down.
Yeah, sex.
Somebody's tampered with your encoder.
Jim?
If we knew the last time and position the Devonshire thought she was, could you figure out exactly where she sank?
So I guess I don't know what James Bond's history, his naval history is.
He's a naval commander.
They do call him Commander Bond at some point during
But I always feel like that's what he used to be before he went into MI6. So
yes, but he's still in a branch of the service, though. No. MI6 is a branch of the British.
Okay.
Military.
Of the British.
So this is the the next set piece we're going to see is the halo jump.
I have some issues with this. Did we already miss the car the car parking garage thing?
Yeah, we sure did.
Because I have a problem
you
with that.
You have some problems with that. Let's talk about it.
It has maybe the second most reversed engineered gadget, and that is the hood ornament saw built only to cut a cable at a specific height.
How else is that useful other than to cut a decapitation wire that is exactly that height?
Ridiculous.
I know.
Ridiculous.
It's funny, yeah, you get this like glamour shot of the BMW logo too, and then it turns into this saw that is only there to cut that.
That is everything about this movie in 3 seconds.
Listen, I always had a little tiny problem with that as a kid.
Yeah.
But I enjoyed how stocked that BMW was as far as gadgets are concerned. And that, again, much the way they overreacted with the James Bond score going in this movie, they overreacted because there were complaints that the BMW Z3 did nothing.
Yeah.
It had no gadgets in it whatsoever.
So this is just the so most this was gadgety their over car
it is,
they could create.
It is way
the Bond producers do suffer a little bit from. Oh, did we miss that? Well, look out! Here we come. Or do we go too far? Well, you'll get nothing.
Yeah,
there you go. Maybe just a happy medium.
Which is why I'm very curious as to what they're going to do with this next movie.
Yeah,
this next movie.
Yeah, do you think it'll go bigger or back to less?
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess isn't Skyfall, you know, what they say is the most successful Bond movie of all time as far as box office goes.
Yeah.
So, I mean, will they just try and do it again, I guess?
I think so. I think naturally these movies outdo themselves incrementally until they go too big,
and then they have to snap back.
And I think Skyfall shows a little bit of that.
Which is why I think if you look at the franchise of James Bond, if you take if there was somehow a graph of the franchise or like or some sort of a schematic of the James Bond franchise of the 23 movies, as a whole of 23 movies, if you take those 23 movies, put that graph next to one Pierce Brosnan movie, it's the same fucking graph.
It's a fractal, exactly.
If you look at it, it's going to do the exact same thing.
You're absolutely
all happening
right.
in Pierce Brosnan's
Brosnan
James
is
Bond
the
movies.
Franchise
Brosnan's that's why I find him I think he's hated by most.
No, really? I think he's liked by most.
Oh, I think that a lot of people don't enjoy him.
Well, I mean, I know guys our age, like, these were the first Bond movies we saw in theaters, or at least for me anyway. Yeah. So, I mean, I think, like, guys our age will always have a little bit of a sentimental attachment
to
Brosnan. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, and definitely, it's one of those things where every generation has a Bond, and every generation thinks of him in a certain way.
Yeah, so. and I think he gets too much shit. I think he gets too much shit from this podcast. I think he gets too much shit
from Matt Gourley.
From Matt Gourley, specifically Matt Gourley, not Matt Myra. If I'm ever in Malibu and I see you paddleboarding, let's be friends.
you know Brosnan paddleboards.
Oh, yeah, he does. See, that's his favorite thing to do.
I would
ever see him at the climbing gym.
Hell to meet him. Don't get me
wrong.
Oh,
God.
Like I said, it's just not my favorite of the Bond movies. Love them.
Was he at the World's End premiere?
I didn't see him.
I wonder if he went.
What are the good post-Bond Brosnan performances?
The Matador.
The Matador is great. the best Brosnan performance in the Bond time frame is the Thomas Crown Affair.
Yeah.
Which it's
a better
that.
Bond movie than any of his Bond movies. Yeah. It really is.
Have you not seen
it? I've
Thomas
not seen
Crown?
It. I should watch it.
It's really good.
It's okay. Great.
Although, you know, I haven't seen it in years, so maybe it's got dated or something. Yeah. But I remember loving that movie.
Yeah.
Thinking, this is what Bond should be. That, ugh. That's exactly what Bond needed to be at this era, a little smarter. You know?
Yeah.
A little bit more nuanced and
But that's
subtle.
that's a movie that Brosnan produced and had a hand in as
right.
far as making.
Well,
it. So
maybe,
again, this
maybe
is why
Brosnan
I can't
isn't the
This is why I can't blame him for this.
All right, you make a good point. Brosnan, come on the show. Put down the paddle and come on the show.
Also, that is a great movie to see Rene Russo's ass. Which,
not just
which
her,
was
not
delightful.
Just her.
Yeah, yeah.
You get to see the
and Pierce Brosnan's
natural born killers.
But very quickly, if you don't know what a halo jump is, this gentleman right now is about to explain.
Wait, before you do that,
yeah,
I can tell you really quickly. It stands for high altitude, low opening, because yeah. there was a G.I. Joe action figure that had that. But the whole deal with a halo jump and. Is that you have to wear oxygen. You're too high in the Earth's atmosphere, right?
Yeah.
So they open up the back of the C-130 cargo plane, and everybody in the plane isn't wearing oxygen except for the halo jumpers.
Oh, excellent.
Now, maybe there's some like technical aspect of when you jump, it's harder to breathe, so that's why you need it, and there's still oxygen up there. So, fact police, if you're going to send it, when is this podcast going to go out?
Today.
It's going to go out. All right. You have until midnight. Thursday, December, what is today? The 13th?
Yeah.
To send in your fact, please. After that, you don't, if you're listening to this, if it's past midnight of, or midnight of the 14th,
yeah.
don't send it. Yeah. But I think that that's a mistake.
I think, okay, so let's.
You need to put fact police deadlines on some of these.
Fact police deadline. Midnight, all right, December 14th. Yeah. So we're going
to
see
I like how you're taking into account the internet's need to correct you.
It's
and like giving them
amazing.
A little window.
Yeah, it's amazing. Cuz you know they have a point, but you just end up getting 40 or 50 of them.
Again,
and I do like to know the truth. If I'm wrong, I apologize.
Sure. Wade.
Yeah.
Is he always wearing that hat? When did he get that hat?
Jordan Baker is now wearing a colorful fishing hat.
He pulled it out of his I saw him pull
oh,
it out.
Oh, did he? Yeah. Okay.
Here we go.
Thank God, yeah. Thank God this movie holds up then.
Jump, the halo jump is where we get the most fatalities. So listen up. You free fall for 5 miles and use your oxygen or you'll die of asphyxiation.
5 miles, there's no oxygen up there.
Next, after the free fall, pop the shooter 200 feet below the Chinese radar. You'll be traveling over 200 miles an hour. This snaps your head back like a cantaloupe. Be careful not to crack your skull open on the tank.
I'll keep that in mind.
By the
One
way,
one last thing. When you hit the water, don't forget to cut away your chute. 90% of people killed in the halo jump got tangled up in their chutes and drowned. Got it?
Seems like an awful lot just to save the world, Jimbo.
About no choice,
Jimbo.
Wade.
I missed that the
prove
first
that
time.
Ship
That's
was
funny.
Deliberately sent off course.
1 minute.
Pickups.
1 minute.
Also, we're going to train you for this horribly difficult thing just seconds before you do it.
Buddha bless.
He's in the naval. He goes, Buddha bless. He Buddha bless.
Yeah, that was good. I bet that was
this
improvised.
This is where the ship thought it was.
Yeah.
And
more
this is
more
where it really
fun
is.
Poking at Americans right
there?
Here.
Yeah.
Well, that means that where he's actually jumping between the British and Chinese fleets, well, technically they're not Chinese territorial waters.
What?
They belong to Vietnam.
Vietnam?
Vietnam? Does
what?
He have any
we in a war there.
Him?
The parachute, the wetsuit, the fins.
Jeez, if the Vietnamese catch him, they're going to go crazy.
Was that guy briefing him, the guy from Aliens, the sergeant in Aliens? Do you remember?
It might have been.
That's where I recognize him, yeah.
Oh, maybe it's
Stay Frosty.
Pope. Same guy. Yeah. Maybe he gets cryogenically frozen.
Oh, I would love that. Oh, nothing would make me happier as if the James Bond and Alien movie,
oh,
maybe
God.
The universe is overlapped.
And there's
He's
a deleted scene. Deleted scene in Aliens. Going
Aliens
like,
versus Predator versus Bond. Make it.
So now we're in what I call the thunderball of this movie,
yeah.
which is a long, drawn-out underwater scene
Ooh, boy,
to discover what the audience already knows.
Mm. Right.
Mm. Good point.
Which makes it completely useless for me.
It is that is very boring.
I'm actually not even. I'm going to say it's chapter 21.
Okay, really quickly. So they go down. They do that. He meets Wai Lin. They come up and they get captured. Right.
Yeah, they get captured by Carver.
This is just convenient screenwriting because in any other Bond movie, if Bond and Wai Lin are in the surface of the water and there's guys with guns on a boat, so they would have just ducked under or escaped. Like Connery's Bond would have escaped. They just it's just
yeah.
Convenient.
Who would have
they
escaped and like
him.
And like
yeah.
somehow punched a hole in their boat?
Yeah,
that
like
made them.
Why
sink.
That's never stopped him before, and right. now suddenly they just cut to them being captured because it's
plus
where the
they
plot needs to go.
Have oxygen tanks.
Yes. And bullets don't go more than a couple feet underwater.
As
that
Myth
from
Mythbusters has taught us.
Yes, yes, yeah.
So here we are now. This is the scene. I don't know how I feel about this shirt, first of all.
Oh, boy.
Okay, guys.
That's your
here's
problem
my problem.
With this movie?
It's a nice
well,
shirt, huh?
I feel like it's a very, that color, by the way, very 1997.
Mm-hmm.
But
it's like a dark
it's a little
blue.
Looser.
It's, like a...
it's a little looser than I'd like to see him in. I want him in a more fitted shirt.
Are they in his office right now?
They're in Elliot Carver's office.
Is basically a set from the Mortal Kombat movie that came out a couple years earlier.
Yeah. Well, can you
he's
play
in
it?
Shang Tsung's lair.
General Chang is well.
There's a point here where Elliot types something.
I wrote that note too.
When Stephen Colbert types something on his show and he just lets his hands go limp because it's obviously
Elliot.
Just going through the motions.
I hadn't.
It's unbelievable in this movie.
Yeah, you'll be able to hear it too because he's typing one-handed. He's holding a keyboard. Yeah. And
an opening
it's
in
like he has severe
tomorrow,
arthritis.
But as you're here, you can help
you know,
me write the
he's making James Bond write his own obituary.
Yes.
Oh,
I think this is the point where I start to enjoy the movie. I think that up until now it was just total goofballs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think now, like at this point, a lot of cool stuff starts to happen. It's almost like it's
to get
from
him
a different
to understand
movie.
Us. No.
I feel like I am wedged squarely between you two. It's like yeah. I see the. I mean, there is massive amounts of stupidity in
We're
this movie.
We're the Goldilocks of this movie.
But there is
the
some.
Bears,
I don't
bears.
Know. There is some like kind of ingenious, clever stuff. I don't know. I like this bit a lot.
All right, so let's hear him out.
Well, girl's story. Your obituaries.
I hope you extended the same courtesy to Paris.
Actually, Mr. Bond, you're the one who wrote my late wife's obituary. When you asked her to betray me.
Oh, by the way, just quick note about Terry Hatcher's corpse.
British.
He really strokes her hair a lot after she's dead. Isn't that creepy?
Yeah. He does that. Yeah. James Bond interacts with dead bodies in a way that I find disturbing.
<It's true. laughs> He like kisses the dead body. Yeah. It's really weird.
Yeah. He's got a thing. He's got
Secret
a fetish.
Service agent James Bond and his collaborator
License
Wei
to
Lin,
kill and then fuck.
The Chinese People's
after
External Security Force were found dead this
Fuck
morning.
Off. Look at that.
Yeah.
In Vietnam.
I mean, it fits with his acting.
It sure does. But
although
he would have to have his
he
own...
He does hit the enter key correctly.
I think he's got his own rearrangement of letters on there to fit his typing style, because that's certainly not a QWERTY keyboard. He's all over the place.
Yeah, so this scene... Let's play this a little bit more here.
Lex Punch, don't you think?
Oh, it's old news, Elliot. We've been working together for months.
Both our governments know what you and General Chang are up to.
I don't think so.
Very reminiscent of Goldfinger. Mm. A few words you may have overheard. Operation Grand Slam, perhaps.
I mean, it seems him in this black turtleneck, too. It seems too early, but are they trying to evoke Steve Jobs?
I feel like with the glasses and the turtleneck, yes. But this is 1997, so this is just...
Yeah.
This is just when he comes back to Apple and launches the iMac.
I think it's more that they're going for a retro Bond villain thing.
Yeah, because he's got the... What James Bond villains love, don't mind the this is playing
over
in
the background. They hate collars, that's for sure.
Yeah, and they also love buttoning everything to the brink.
Yes. Using every button.
To the brink.
Yes.
I never believe what I read in the press anyway.
Therein lies your problem, Mr. Bond. You see, we're both men of action, but your era and Miss Lynn's
Look
is passing.
Look at Stamper. What is
Words
he dressed?
Are the
what
new
is
weapons?
Going on?
Satellites, the new artillery.
And you become the new supreme allied commander?
Exactly. Caesar had his
this
legions.
This is a great
Napoleon
Bond villain
armies.
Performance.
I have my divisions. TV, news, magazines. And by midnight tonight, which
I'll
will
always be relevant.
More
this is the most
than
impotent
in the history of this planet.
Basis
save
for a
God
movie.
And the best he ever managed was a Sermon on the Mount.
Oh, you really are quite insane.
The distance between insanity and genius is measured only by success.
And acting.
Excuse me.
Which
General
is doing
Chang
a great job.
Waiting.
Bad job. Yeah. Good job.
If you'll forgive me. Your appearance here has forced me to move up my
phoned in Ricky J line of the whole movie. That's yours, man. Yeah,
the biggest disparity between acting ever caught on film.
Should I button the bottom button? It's a cardigan, but it's a vest.
I'll leave you in the capable hands of Mr. Stamper and his toys.
He does all
Perhaps
my
Perhaps you'd like to see them.
Sir,
I do like the helicopter. I do like the delivery.
Mr. Stamper is a protege of the late Dr. Kaufman, who was schooling him in the ancient art of chakra torture.
He was like a father to me.
Really?
That's his only good
Interesting
one.
Role model.
According to Eastern philosophy, the body has 7 chakra points. Energy centers, like the heart.
Stamper's the reaction to that is a little indignant. Like, well, that kind of made me upset.
Inflicting
you hurt my
the maximum
feelings.
Amount of pain.
You guys know your enemies, right? You must be prepared for him to not like that.
Dr.
Right.
Kaufman's record was 52 hours. I'm hoping to break it.
I would have thought watching your TV shows was torture enough.
Ba-boom.
Boom.
Oh, and then they cut to Waylon, like, oh, that got him.
When you remove Mr. Bond's
heart, he insulted the quality of his TV shows.
There should be enough time for him to watch it stop beating.
Excuse me.
Now we come to the escape, which was the director's answer to the tank chase in GoldenEye. I saw an interview with him saying... Everyone talked about
That's
the GoldenEye
like.
Chase.
It feels like I got
to
top
And he's
that.
Like, well, I can't get a bigger vehicle, so I'll get a smaller vehicle.
How does it start in the first place? They just sit on that thing, and there's no key or anything. He just starts the motorcycle.
There's a moment where they're handcuffed together. They're trying to find a motorcycle to escape on.
Naturally.
They go to a lot of different motorcycles in this motorcycle rack. It's like a bike rack, but for motorcycles. Yeah. There's 10 of these. Mm-hmm. Although it's, where have we decided it is? Thailand?
We decided it was Singapore, right?
Okay, yep. So,
who cares where it really is? I just want to know what we decided.
Yeah. So there's a lot of motorcycles there. Yep. They try and sit on a couple different ones, and then they finally decide on one to sit on. And it's a huge BMW logo. It's like Bond is saying, no, I'm contractually obligated to take the BMW.
That is a 1997 BMW RC1200, which is a motorcycle that obviously if I were to get a motorcycle, it'd be I'd get a Triumph Bonneville, like 70s, and then that would be the next one I would get after that. Okay, they were manufactured from 97 to 2005. They're a touring bicycle. So,
well, they're also an escaping helicopter.
And I said bicycle.
Motorcycle.
I didn't mean bicycle.
That's me.
Motorcycle.
During the motorcycle versus helicopter chase, all I wrote down in the notes is, this is great. I just enjoyed it so much.
All I wrote down was Universal Studios stunt show. It looks like it's shot on a set. The whole thing just feels canned and storyboarded, and like they are trying to outdo the tank chase. It just doesn't feel organic.
Well, what do you think about them escaping via the banner?
That's kind of fun. It visually looks cool.
It's very fun.
Yeah, well, it's not fun enough to make this a good movie.
I think I enjoy how relieved
That's
they
cool.
are. You're hearing the banner rip as they fall down.
There's a sense of danger here. Yeah. I think they believe that they could actually die.
It goes on a little long, though.
It's a long banner.
Right? What do you think about that? What do you think about that James Bond acting right there?
It's rough.
Oh, he.
Yowza.
He's got banner acting. Who knew a man had banner acting?
Yowza.
Charlie Callis. This is Charlie Callis.
Do you notice Katie's gone? Like that's what this movie. Our engineer isn't even here anymore.
We occasionally do podcasts longer than the movies, and this is one of them.
How long have we gone on?
It's 12 o'clock.
Oh, we gotta hurry this up. Come on, this movie does not deserve this. Okay,
it's our most debated movie yet. Of course, it deserves
all right,
it.
All right.
Enough. Listen, we gotta give the people what they want. If you are interested,
I'm in it for the long haul, guys.
You can still buy a BMW RC1200 in case you're wondering.
Is this podcast sponsored by BMW?
It should be.
And Starbucks Orange Valencia Refreshers.
We're still going, Katie.
I know.
Hang tight.
Sorry, Katie.
We're trying to break our previous record. They're still pretty expensive. Like, you're going to pay about $18,000 for one.
I am?
Yeah, if you want one.
Oh, okay. I'm pretty
They're only
I'm
manufactured
good.
From 1994 to 2005. Oh. Anyway, much like Pierce Brosnan's James Bond career.
Yeah.
So they here's something different though. I think in The World Is Not Enough, the cord he takes out of the blinds,
yeah,
and then jumps off the thing and then tugs at,
yeah,
to land perfectly at street level.
Yeah.
I enjoy that this lands on the 20th floor.
I can't remember how they get down. Do they just pull a diehard?
They, no.
They smash through.
They smash through this window.
The window. To, and these office workers
and acknowledge
are just like,
these office workers.
Yeah, diehard.
But they very quickly, they very quickly straighten up. Like, oh, sorry, we were so silly here.
I think this is the like hardest comedy take in the movie.
Yeah,
like
right
this
here.
Is the most Chandleriest thing that he does.
Could I be any more dirty?
Could I have surprised you more by smashing through the window?
Yes, yes, yes.
With BMW, no. Oh, BMW, BMW, BMW. Okay. No, it's inventive.
Comedy.
She has to straddle him while they motorcycle.
How does he start it?
He hot-wired it.
There could have been a key in it.
Stop fidgeting back there.
So now he's in a race with a bunch of 97 Range Rovers. Great year for the Range Rover.
We can't watch this.
We can't. You're right. Yeah, it's gonna take
but forever. I do want to note that it ends with a huge explosion, and then the very next shot transitions into a baby's butt showering.
Yeah. Why are they showering is my question. They've got
to
stop
they
World
War III. They have debris
stop,
all over them.
They have to stop World War III.
But why is that baby's butt standing in the shot? You know what I'm talking about? When
yeah,
they're
I know
showering
what you're
off
about,
to the right.
Because that baby's being bathed.
But it's
they're at the bathing
so,
sector
so
of the
totally
tiny community.
Weird. You go action sequence, and then there's just a baby's butt showcased.
Well, more so than action sequence followed by baby's butt, I did think tonally it was an odd choice to have that explosion and not sort of see a follow-up explosion. So what happens is they ride a motorcycle. By the way, if anyone's listening to this, like...
At this point.
Thank you. I love just trying to explain this. There is a helicopter with the blades trained down at them.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Like...
Would bring down the helicopter in an instant.
Yes, I'm sure...
Touching
I'm sure John Landis finds this scene uncomfortable.
Oh, hey.
They slide their motorcycle under the blades,
uh-huh,
take a clothes hanger, whip it up at the tail rotor,
mm-hmm,
and then obviously the helicopter then just spins in on itself and explodes.
And then I think his quip to her afterwards, he's like, you were pretty good with that hook. And she's like, I grew up in a rough neighborhood.
Yeah.
Where we hit each other with hooks.
And helicopters came at us all the time.
But there's a very strange cut here. So he takes this, throws it up on the rotor blade. David Arnold's pumping.
Yeah.
I had no idea how clearly those were dummies until just now.
Oh, I didn't see.
Watch the men in the... I've never seen a shot like that in a movie until just now. I don't know why I'm trying to land that any better. Yeah, here. Oh, fuck. Anyway, here.
Yeah, they take refuge in that well.
Yeah, now, guys, pay attention to inside the cockpit of the helicopter. Not this shot. Second to last shot.
Real people. Dummies. They just,
like,
their hands are in their side.
Yeah,
they're just...
What?
Their
why
hands are just there.
They're like store mannequins, even.
I'm going to screenshot that. Okay.
Waiting to die.
Second shot.
Yeah, they don't seem too concerned at all that they're about.
Huge explosion. They duck under the water.
Fade out.
Fade
to black.
Fade out.
And then just.
And then there's that baby you're talking about.
All kinds of baby ass.
But I don't know why they're showering.
But it's. Pause it. It's very seemingly sexual on the left. He's got his shirt off. There's sunlight coming through. There's something very sensual about it. And then you see a baby's butt, and the two, it's just, that is
I think
negating
just
any
perfect
sexuality.
Metaphor
I
for
think,
the Brosnan film.
I think right they're there. Trying to establish that this is the bathing sector of this little shantytown.
I think they're
where
trying
everyone
that.
Bathes.
Yeah, but...
Yeah,
if Paul Verhoeven directed this, there would be just naked women all around bathing each other.
So she leaves Bond at the thing so that we can have a 3-minute John Woo-esque kung fu scene. Because, again, very popular at the time.
Sure.
When
did Crouching Tiger come out?
Later.
Okay. Oh, really?
But this would be like, remember Rumble in the Bronx came out in like 95, 96? Yeah. It was like a big deal. Everybody's doing their own stunt situation. That was a huge deal.
Yeah, I feel like that little trend happens today where, you know, like in the Expendable movies, they will just give Jet Li a scene that's kind of not related to what's going on to just kung fu some dudes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But she, I don't know, she just doesn't quite have the charisma to be justified just for the martial arts stuff. Yes.
Yeah. I kind of enjoy the martial arts fight. I think the fighting is very cool in this
part. I do love is when Jonathan Pryce does his fake karate at her.
Oh, so racist.
Oh my God, so delightfully racist.
He might as well, like, with his index fingers, pull his eyes slanty at that moment. That is...
Now, what do you think of this scene as a Bond fan of James just hanging around her little compound playing with stuff?
Oh, I like the... I mean, kind of in the same way that I liked that scene where MI6 is sniping against the other agencies. I like seeing, I like the idea that she's the Chinese James Bond.
Yeah.
That, you know, we could just have a movie about her, you know, doing some Chinese stuff.
Which I'm sure they would have gone for.
Yeah.
She's a much more viable character than Jax.
I think this is one of the things about this movie.
Yeah. Not Jax. I was thinking Mortal Kombat.
She has a robot arm, right?
But look how the keyboard and monitors are all red.
Yeah, I thought that was fucking gross.
Or is that just light? No, sure isn't.
No, he can't type on a keyboard with Chinese characters.
Sure. You type.
First, we have to find the boat.
So now they're in Wei Lin's. What do you call it? Her headquarters? Her apartment?
Yeah, her fortress of solitude.
Do you think that James Bond's apartment has any sort of thing like this?
His reaction there is good, though. I like that.
Right?
It's pretty funny.
Yeah.
For the folks at home, he tapped a dragon head, which shot fire out of it.
I don't get that this is her home. This is just a station outpost or something.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
She's got a collection of fancy watches, just like him.
Yeah. All right, we can't linger on this too long.
Okay. But this is when he gets the Walther P99.
Yeah, it carries on
through the rest of the movies except for Skyfall.
Right. Now, he shoots that at the end with a silencer on, and the whole time it's making unsilenced gun noises. Did you notice that?
No, I didn't notice.
Yeah.
Well, he is at the end of this movie, they're both double gunning.
Mm-hmm.
They both have two guns that are meant to be held with two hands.
Sure.
Now, this is the second of the two British offs.
Okay, I'm in.
This is aboard the HMS Bedford.
Missile lock on. Send a signal to the Admiralty.
There's the Last Crusade guy.
Under missile attack.
Oh, yeah, he was the...
The miniatures are great in this. I always love the James Bond miniature work.
I like that the miniature guy got a credit in the opening.
Did he? Is it Derek Meddings?
I forget. Because
he did GoldenEye, right? The GoldenEye stuff is so great. Even though you can kind of tell it's a miniature in this by the size of the waves when they're the big stealth boat. It's just so great. I love it.
Here's the British off, everybody.
Have you got anything on the radar that looks very small? Lifeboat, periscope, anything?
No, sir.
A stealth boat, so they have gone mad.
I love how much they say stealth boat in this.
Stealth boat, sir.
They have gone mad.
They've gone bloody bonkers.
Boats that no one can see.
They've
positively
gone
bonkers.
Absolutely balmy.
So, look at that. Good shot, right? There she is. She's good. She's flying up in the air. She's going to kick some people.
Yeah.
Let's, because we got to wrap up. Let's jump over to the end confrontation between Jonathan Pryce and James Bond.
You're too late again, Mr. Bond. It's a bad habit of yours. There's nothing you can do.
James has just seen a label.
Mm-hmm.
Called remote drill. Remote control.
Yeah, right after Jonathan Pryce says there's nothing you can do about it, they go to a shot of a button flashing override. Well, I can push this button, it flashes and says exactly what it does.
There is something you can do about it.
Yeah. Override. It's so goofy. Everything is labeled so plainly.
And thanks largely to your efforts,
you should just say missile
British
stop
Navy
now.
Will destroy the evidence. And I'll be out of here.
In a post Austin Powers era, this movie is dead on arrival.
This is Austin Powers era.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. It's post Austin Powers.
Austin Powers came out in 97 also.
Did it?
Yeah.
Oh, well, maybe. Well, it made a salient point then.
Bring the event. It's going to be a fantastic show.
I like how we can operate that
have some breaking
without
news
looking at it.
For you, Elliot.
Breaking news for you, Elliot. Come on.
He's a news guy.
No, I get that this movie's written.
They work with a loose outline.
Give the people what they want.
Pretty gruesome. Drill back. Pretty gruesome. We all enjoyed the drill the first time.
Love it. Yeah.
I love that. It's a good death, yeah.
Wait, so let's recap.
I didn't say there aren't like,
let's
fun
recap.
Little things.
Let's recap all the things we enjoy about this movie.
And then recap and all will... the things we don't.
So, obviously, he has a fight with the baddie, because after you kill the main bad guy, you always have to fight the henchman.
Sure.
Yeah.
Just kind of backwards. Weird way it works in James Bond movies. Because you always forget about the henchman because you killed the main guy.
This is the least memorable henchman movie ever.
So at the end of this movie, everything's happy. He's on a boat. He wants to be left on the boat or on the wreckage so he can fuck Waylon, which is the James Bond way to go. Don't get rescued where you could fuck on a bed.
Yeah, fuck in the most
uncomfortable place you are.
Yeah.
Which in this case happens to be the wreckage of a stealth boat.
I bet James Bond, has done so much fucking. At this point, he probably can't get it up unless it's in a crazy situation. True. He probably just can't go to dinner or a movie.
He needs to smell sulfur of gunpowder to get an erection.
He needs to have a rifle trained on him.
He fucks wounds. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
He's
a wound fucker.
And then the movie ends. Everybody's happy, except for Matt Gourley.
Well, why did they need to cover up Carver's death? Why couldn't they say, this is this guy Carver, he did all this? Why did they need to say it was a suicide?
For comeuppance.
Themes?
Comeuppance.
The movie needs themes. And
I'm
what
sure
is,
there's a lot of stuff out there, Matt, that we don't understand.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, let me put it to you this way so I don't seem like a negative Nancy.
All right.
What's your least favorite Bond movie?
This is a question I get frequently.
Is it?
And I think it is Die Another Day.
Okay. And you don't... I have more fun watching Die Another Day than I do with this. This movie just isn't fun to me.
No. I get so angry at Die Another Day. Oh. I get so angry because of the time... It came out in 2002, okay? Mm-hmm. It came out at a time where we knew how to make really awesome movies as a people. Like, it came at a
time...
Well,
we weren't... 1997 wasn't the 20s.
1997 was... But this is very much of that era of products, you know? So, what I'm saying is they put in the time. They made a film like GoldenEye. They made a film like Tomorrow Never Dies. The World Is Not Enough is, while not great, is fine. It's fine.
That's its problem.
It's fine. And then Die Another Day, which was the 20th James Bond movie. It was supposed to be this huge, great, awesome nod to the past kind of a thing. And they fucking blew it at every turn in that movie. That movie, for me, has zero enjoyable moments. Like, that movie has no... There's no scene I can point to that's like him at Oxford with Aston Martin, or like him in the car with M and Moneypenny and Robinson. Like, that movie has none of those scenes.
It has a couple for me, I guess.
Well, for me, there's nothing enjoyable. That one has a fucking sword fight with Madonna.
Yeah.
That one
Madonna's in the movie?
Yeah.
I've never seen that one.
Oh my God.
It's rough. I'm not defending that movie. I'm just saying at least it's so bad that I am enjoying it. This one is just...
This one is so much better than that one. Mm. And I also feel like this one is a lot better than people are giving it credit for. And people, specifically, I mean, my other Matt.
And when people say this is, in some ways, a return to classic Bond, that
I'm
may be why I have a problem with it, though. But because it's such a mediocre version of that it takes a step backwards to me. And considering the style and the tone shifts, it is, to me, the most mediocre and the worst of the Bond
I would
films.
Argue that the tone doesn't shift as much as you think it shifts.
I would argue that you're absolutely wrong.
I think there is a tone for the movie, and that tone is 1997 action movie.
Well, maybe that's
and
my problem.
Fucking
maybe
nails that
tone. Genre or that era. But the good thing is,
next week is Diamonds Are Forever, and I love that movie. I love that movie. So I don't want you to think I'm going to be complaining.
I enjoy watching Diamonds Are Forever, but it's a piece of shit.
Oh, it's a wonderful piece of shit, though.
Yeah.
And we're starting to get into an era of Bond films that I just adore, and those early Moores. And,
yeah.
And,
we're also getting into an era of this podcast where we are now doing them day of.
I know. This has got to be the closest recording to release. Like, do we want to talk up? Speaking of the news, it's topical. We can talk about topical events because it'll go out today.
Yeah, no shit.
Did you hear a boat of British sailors were murdered off the coast?
British sailors murdered? Did you leak this?
Everyone's going to be up in arms.
Jordan, what is your opinion on the movie?
I think I sit in the middle in that the... I'd say that, you know, it's funny because I watched this movie in two distinct halves. Here's what I did. I ordered the disc from Netflix when we set this up.
Sure.
It came broken.
You mean it was perfectly functional, the movie itself?
Yeah, so, and I'm like, this can't be the movie. This is probably a dirty disc or something.
Oh, that is so metaphoric.
So I went on the PlayStation Network to try and rent it. Uh-huh. PlayStation Network was down.
Oh,
so I do not like to steal from the internet.
You tried to get it through legal means.
I tried to. I just went on Dailymotion and watched it in two chunks with Chinese subtitles, by
sure.
the way.
Sure. Best way to do it.
Yeah. So I definitely watched it in two halves and definitely felt like that second half I just enjoyed because you're right. It is a 90s action movie. And those, you know, for all their stupidity, they're fun. They're a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, kind of, they're inventive in their, you know, in their action. And, you know, like, I definitely have a soft spot for Face Off, Con Air, The Rock, et cetera.
Yeah.
So this kind of reminded me of that. And you know, like, and Pierce Brosnan has his moments.
Yeah.
But I thought the first half was so goofballs and seemed like a parody of Bond movies. And then the second half just seemed like this other kind of movie that is maybe a little bit forgettable, but has a lot of fun moments.
You might be better off watching this in two halves, because I think the first half does spoil it for me so much that it taints the second half.
Yeah,
next time I watch it, just watch
Whereas I feel like
go on Daily Motion, search Tomorrow Never Dies Part 2.
But I feel like the first half of the movie, I feel like if you gave me this movie in a format where I could cut it, I could edit this into your favorite James Bond movie.
No way.
I could, and I accept the challenge. I will be doing
I accept
week.
You to do that challenge, but I'll be honest with you. I just don't want you to do all that work for nothing. For nothing.
Because I feel like there are some scenes where it drags too much. You know, first thing that comes to mind is the underwater bullshit. Yeah. I always find underwater
scenes
boring.
But I'm well gone by that point.
Well,
wasn't that the whole premise of Thunderball is like, what if James Bond went underwater?
Yeah. Oh, we found out. Yeah. A big nap.
As in Moonraker, what if he goes to space?
Well, that one's great.
Here's maybe also why I didn't like Bond that much as a kid, is because one day my dad was at the video store and he called and said, what do you want me to get from the video store? And I said, Moonwalker, Michael Jackson's Moonwalker.
No,
and my dad brought back Moonraker because he misheard me.
Oh,
and I was
so
disappointed.
Oh,
I just
God.
Wanted to see Michael Jackson turn into a spaceship.
Oh, I love that story.
Jesus.
One thing we should cover is that this movie ends with a tribute to Cubby Broccoli, because this is when he passed away. And I think we should pay our respects to that wonderful, wonderful man.
Cubby. Thank you for having the foresight.
Even in these movies, I thank you for what?
Thank you for having the foresight to make these movies.
Lovable, lovable man. Give us a big hug. Come here, Cubby. Come here.
Aww.
Come here.
Now go make us some pasta in mass. That's what we love doing.
In Tunisia.
We loved watching the circus set up.
Yeah.
Baby, Kabibble, I'm Cubby Broccoli.
So I guess what I'm saying is, I think this is the best Pierce Brosnan James Bond movie.
I think it's the worst James Bond movie.
Yep, that's where we are on this.
And I know that's
fine.
Not a popular.
Mind you, I haven't. Maybe I'll change my mind when I rewatch GoldenEye. I haven't rewatched that in a while, but
yeah.
I think just for where it was, mind you, again, I was 14 years old when this movie came out. So this movie hit me in that sweet spot of where Octopussy hit you.
Mm. Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
What do. I'd like to take the temperature of James Bond nerds. Mm-hmm. What do they think is the worst James Bond movie? Is there a consensus?
Probably Die Another Day, I think.
If you go earlier, there's a lot of dislike for Moonraker.
And View to a Kill.
And View to a Kill, yeah.
Which I also feel is like experiencing.
Very enjoyable.
Yeah, me too. And I think like the more we talk to people, the more people have a real soft spot for View to a Kill, which I'm very encouraged about.
Yeah, because everybody we know is between the ages of 30 and 43 years old.
Yeah, and we're just prime viewing age when that came out.
But yeah, Jordan, thank you for
Jordan. Yeah, thanks for having me.
Show.
This was a lot of fun.
You can check Jordan out on Twitter at Jordan Morris, correct?
At Jordan underscore Morris.
Jordan underscore
Anything
Morris.
Else you'd like to plug?
I've got a podcast. It's called Jordan Jesse Go. You can find it in iTunes. You could find it at MaximumFun.org. Both of the Matts have been on it.
Yep.
That's right.
So those would be good places for you to start if you enjoy this show.
Great. Thank you for being on our show.
Thank you.
I get a lot of tweets, people asking me what the other Matt's Twitter handle is.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh.
So what I'm saying right now is it's Matt Gourley, MattGourley. Follow him at Matt Gourley. He's my better half, if you will.
That's true. And you are my better half.
He's got not great opinions about this movie.
It's true.
But I find that he's pretty spot on with the rest of his opinions.
I was going to say, I think you guys have a real fun dynamic.
We do.
I like this a lot. I like you the contention. It was really fun for me.
It's a happy marriage, and we just have this one sticking point, because we really do agree
on almost everything
but this movie.
On almost everything.
Yeah.
Follow the podcast at James Bonding Pod. You can follow me at Matt Myra, MattMira, but mostly Matt Gourley.
No.
And we'll be back. James Bonding will return in Diamonds Are Forever.
Diamonds Are Forever.
We are just waiting for Douglas Benson to nail down a time,
I don't want to speak too soon, but my schedule is now pretty, well, relatively open, so we should be able to get these things.
You say I start back on work next week.
Oh, Christ.
Thank you guys thank you everybody. Katie Moneypenny finally made her return to the podcast. We've been doing it solo for a little while. Thank you to Katie for sitting through what's the time code at right now? I just want to
207.
2 hours and 7 minutes.
Longest episode yet?
I think
yes.
I think
yes. I feel like I won something.
That was 8 minutes longer than the movie. Okay. Goodbye. We will see you again.
Now leaving Nerdist.com.